Welcome back to opening day of the 1999 College World Series here in America's heartland. The road to Omaha brings us 8 great teams, 9 wonderful days, and just one ultimate prize. The national championship is close at hand.
We took the field on a perfect day. It was right out of the train. Never seen a sky so crystal clear. Never walked on grass so green. And in the stands when they clap their hands, well, I could feel it in my chest. And I come from almost every state to find out who's the best. Put me in, I'm your man, I promise I can do it all. And it feels so good to breathe the air back home in Omaha. Hills to the Golden Gate, to the warm Miami shore. They play the game, a thousand names you've never heard before. Yeah, but don't forget a single face. You could see that boy again. And somewhere down the road you might say, hey, I remember when. Cause there's a dream in every club, there's a on every ball. And once again, they'll make their name back home in Omaha.
Nebraska. Today's opening round continues with game 2. Rice against the number 1 seed, Miami. Once again, Rosenblatt Stadium is the perfect setting for the championship of Division 1 college baseball. Rain has been in the forecast, but we have been very lucky. The weather has cooperated. And for the first time ever, the tournament started with 64 teams. Here's the top half of our field of 8 that have made it here to Omaha. Earlier today, Alabama knocked off Oklahoma State in this double elimination format. So the way it works, Alabama will take on the winner of tonight's game. Oklahoma State will meet the loser of this game. In bracket 2, play begins tomorrow afternoon. Second-seeded Florida State against Texas A&M. And then in the night game, Stanford and Cal State Fullerton. Good evening, everybody. Mike Patrick along with Harold Reynolds. It's great to have you with us. The College World Series is always a special 8 days of baseball, but never more than this year because Omaha is celebrating its 50th anniversary as the host city of this event. 80% of the people who fill up the stands behind us, and we expect record crowds again this week, are from Omaha and the surrounding area, and it is a tribute to them that this event has become such a marvelous success and an American amateur treasure in athletics. It's just great.
It is.
Miami must consider this place their second home. The Hurricanes have been here 18 times, including the last 6 straight. And Harold, they come in here this year as the number 1 seed. How do you think they stack up against the rest of the field?
Well, they actually stack up quite well. They probably play the toughest of all the teams in the country. They play the toughest schedule. Now, they beat the team ranked number 2, seeded 2, Florida State, 5 out of 6 times just to show the dominance. 46 wins is nothing to sneeze at, so you know they got a tremendous program. They continue to play very competitive ball.
One guy that might exemplify their team, their shortstop, Bobby Hill.
Well, he's a guy here who you thought would go early in the first round. He went in the second round of the draft. Tremendous player. Great range. You'll see the full package. Really a throwback, kind of the shortstop, not the power type, but the guy's going to put the ball in play and move it around. And that's what this Miami team really does instead of the gorilla ball that we've seen in a lot of college baseball.
Exactly. And this is a great matchup between these two ball clubs. Stay with us. We're at the College World Series in Omaha. We'll be back with the starting lineups right after this.
service selection, a price that's right. It's part of the feeling. And we're working in hand to give you the best deal.
Helping his children get an A on a spelling test or teaching them how to parallel park, Joseph A. Bank would like to pay tribute to these executives with our Father's Day sale. Up to 60% off throughout every Joseph A. Bank store. Spring sport coats as low as $124.99. And all executive collection wool suits now only $199.99. Plus big savings on cotton fashion dress shirts, silk ties, and cotton polo shirts. That's the Joseph A. Bank Father's Day sale. Joseph A. Bank. Smart clothing. Smart customers.
Welcome back to the College World Series in Omaha. We've got Miami against Rice, and there is the Rice head coach, Wayne Graham, in his eighth year, who has done a tremendous job in building this program to a state of national prominence. Here is the way his lineup looks today. Charles Williams will lead it off and play left field. Brett Smith, the second baseman, bats second. Last year's player of the year, Damon Thames, the shortstop, hits third. He's followed by the cleanup man, Will Ford, in right. Jason Gray, the center fielder, hits fifth. In the number sixth hole, the designated hitter, Justin Berg. Jacob Baker, the first baseman, bats seventh. Zane Curry is the catcher, and batting ninth and playing third base is Matt Fox.
And David Gill will be on the mound for Miami. This guy right here, seventh round draft pick. Strong junior pitcher, great deliveries around the plate a lot. They made a switch tonight, Mike, and they decided to go with Gill on a gut instinct by the pitching coach. And last time they did that, he pitched a three-hit shutout.
The gut instincts sometimes are the best things about athletics, and especially about pitching the way Miami has done it this year. They have pushed all the right buttons with all the injuries they have had, and overcoming all the adversity to get to where they are right now. 0-1 to Williams. Hitting .368 with seven home runs as the leadoff man. He's had a tremendous postseason, the MVP of the WAC tournament. Pops this one foul, back out of play on the left side.
He's a fifth-round draft pick of the St. Louis Cardinals this year, and this young man, yeah, he's playing right field, but they feel like, I mean left field, but they feel like he could play anywhere in the outfield. Just a tremendous athlete, switch hitter.
1-2. Gill misses outside with a fastball. Wind blowing to right, which indicates there's a possibility of weather coming. The predominant wind is to left. Oh, way inside. Trying to tell the umpire he was nicked by that pitch, but Dan Peterson is not buying it.
Well, I'm surprised he even got out of the way of that one.
Me too.
As soon as he released it, you could tell that ball was coming at him. Now, look at Smith jump out of the way, and as a good leadoff hitter would do, he tried to go on down to first.
Full count to Williams. Got him on the called strike three.
Well, again, the generous outside, we've seen that all day, and Gill not afraid to go ahead, and they're going to give me the, he gave it to him on the first pitch, the ball outside. He said, let me go ahead and pan it again on the third pitch.
One of Miami's strong suits is defense. Let's take a look at the way they line up. Lolly Esquivel, the third baseman, Bobby Hill, tremendous range and short. This one is fouled off. Flute to the second baseman, Brown at first behind the plate. Greg Lovelady, one of the major surprises to this ball club, as you see Jim Morris in his sixth season. The outfield, Rodriguez, Seaver, and Crespo, all of them get a good jump on the ball. The number two hitter is Brett Smith, the 301 hitter, the second baseman. This team has some offensive skills. Rice has averaged over 8 runs and 12 hits a game this year, and better than a .330 batting average. And in the postseason, they have the batting average up over .365 as a team.
And as a unit, they pride themselves in making contact with two strikes and just putting the ball in play. That's been one of their big keys to success.
One thing that will do is raise the pitch count, and they want to get rid of that starting pitcher. Their goal is by the seventh inning. Just missed on the outside, so after striking out Williams, Gill gives up a walk to Brett Smith. And now the heart of the order with Damon Thames. Last year's Coaches Association Player of the Year, passed on the draft, and less than $100,000 bonus from the Yankees to come back to play his senior year. You don't think he was popular with his teammates when he announced he was coming back to play one more year? And believe it or not, at 377, his numbers are down from a year ago.
Yeah, but you start talking about a guy having a down year, you're thinking he hit about 250. 377 and had a bad year? I'd take that any day.
He had 424 as a freshman. Had 26 home runs, only 9 this year. A lot of people feel he felt the pressure of being expected to hit home runs this season.
Really into his academics, too, and Coach was saying that has a little bit to do with the fact that you may not have thought he was there all the time.
Well, he has 3 majors. I didn't have 1. Political science, economics, and managerial stuff.
And that's why he came back to school. He wanted to finish his education out. He felt like if I get a degree from Rice, there's nothing that I can't do.
If you can get into Rice, there's nothing you can't do. Checking throw over to first, and Smith hustles back.
Boy, but as a ball player, I got a chance to watch him take ground balls, and he is as graceful as any shortstop you're going to see.
I could tell you were really impressed.
Yes. It was fun watching him.
Hit on the ground toward the hole. Stopped by the third baseman, Esquivel. He goes to second, not in time.
It's a great effort by Esquivel right here. Now, Mike Thames gets a pitch inside and hammers it. Now, you got to give Brett Smith some credit for hustling. But you see the dive. It pulls it, but the glove pulled it back to his body. He wasn't able to get rid of it as quick as he wanted to. But Brett Smith, off and running, made that play happen because he actually got rid of this ball quick enough to get anybody that's running. And Smith had a great jump and got a great effort down there to go ahead and get the base hit for Thames and force the action.
So Rice causing some trouble here in the bottom of the first. A walk and an infield single has runners at first and second. With one out for the cleanup man, Will Ford leads the club in home runs and RBIs, 11 and 70 respectively. Power hitter with the wind blowing out to right, and David Gill has to be careful with this kid.
And Gill's continued to pound the outside half of the plate, so you're not really going to see him get a chance to jerk a ball. Maybe he'll get a breaking pitch on the inside half, but he continues to throw that fastball away. We'll see as if his philosophy changes as the at-bat goes.
That was high and inside. I said he was the leading home run hitter and the leading RBI man. He's number 2 with those numbers, 11 and 70. The leader is on deck. That would be Jason Gray with 19 dingers on the year. Right on the corner.
You can see why the Miami staff is excited about Gill. He is able to pinpoint the ball where he wants to so far. Even the base hit he gave up to Thames was a pitch that jammed him on the inside half. So not really getting some good swings at him right now.
1-2, line into left field for the base hit. Smith around third. He'll score. Thames on his way to third. He'll make it. And into second base goes Ford. Great hustle.
Great hustle and a great read. Now Ford has to make his decision when he comes around first base to see where that throw is going. When Rodriguez came up and threw to third, he'll cut it off obviously to go to second base. But Ford had already made up his mind that he was going to stretch this into two. Great hustle, great play all the way around. And again, Mike, that was a ball that they inside outed. Good piece of hitting. And Coach talked about that this morning. They like to go inside out. You'll see a lot of inside out, inside the ball swings from this ball club.
They're very, very protective of the plate with two strikes. And I think that makes guys a lot better hitters when they're schooled to do that. You'll see them get a lot of two-strike base hits.
Absolutely. Most guys do not cut the swing down with two strikes, and that's what you need to do to play team baseball and not individual, I'm going to try to hit a home run every swing baseball.
All right, speaking of that, if you're Jason Gray right now with runners at second and third and one out, you're the power guy. Are you just trying to get something in play and get somebody home?
You want to get a ball inside, so you can either pull it. You got the right side of the infield back. You see him take a pitch and try to pull that ball, swing, try to take that, pull the ball right there. But you want to get a ball that you can pull or either hit it into this wind and maybe pick up three. But you want to try to move the runners if you can. Get the double bonus to run scores and move the man to third base.
Gill still favoring that outside part of the plate. Now the catcher sets up inside, got him on the fists.
So a little more action early in the second game than we saw the first game. You know, the bases were loaded early for Oklahoma State. They weren't able to push anything through today. Tonight, Rice putting the heat on the pitcher. They've already picked up one run.
And Gill cannot afford to give up many more. Miami has not been swinging the bat really well in the postseason. In fact, last couple of weeks, this one's popped foul and will reach the seats.
Well, you're absolutely right, Mike. You know, Miami coach Jim Morris talked about the fact that they are a team that's going to manufacture. You know, we're not going to hit home runs and hurt people that way with the three-run homer. We've got to manufacture runs. And so a team that manufactures can't afford to get too far behind.
Takes you out of your running game.
Absolutely. Of course, in this ballpark, it adds a little more power to your lineup.
Absolutely. Guys with warning track power are hitting him off the light tower here. Outside, that'll be a full count to Jason Gray. Runners at second and third, one gone, one already in here in the Rice first inning. Fouled out of play again.
Well, there's that approach that I was talking about. You know, we've been discussing that. Stay inside the baseball. And what that means, you pick out the inside half of that ball, and it causes you to stay on the ball a little bit more. You want to shoot that ball as you get a good look at Coach Wayne Graham. He's taught this philosophy. He said, hey, I did it back in the 50s. I know it works. But with a left-handed hitter, you want to try to shoot the ball to left center field. That will keep you on the inside half of the baseball. And if they juice you one inside, you'll still be able to turn on it because you'll be quick enough. But making contact is the key.
Gill already with 26 first-inning pitches. Again, off the fist. Talking about staying inside, to me, that means staying back and being patient
right.
And waiting.
You're absolutely right. The only way you're going to stay inside the ball is to stay back and see the ball. When you stay back, it allows you to see the ball a lot longer as opposed to jumping out to go get it.
And Gray fouling him off, really making David Gill work. Ready for another 3-2 pitch. Foul back out of play again.
Well, here it is, Mike. Here's a good look at staying inside the ball. Now watch, he'll take an approach where he stays back, and right there, see how he fouled that ball, but the approach was to go to left center field. See the ball waiting back in on him? And with an aluminum bat, you can even do that a lot longer because your bat's not going to break.
Another 3-2, and he lost him.
That's a great at-bat right there.
Isn't it? Second walk of the inning for David Gill, and it loads him up. And Laser Collazo, the pitching coach, is going to come out to talk to Gill. So for maybe one of the few times this year, that gut feeling that they had about going with a different starter may backfire on them. They've been pushing all the right buttons, but that can't last forever.
No, the big surprise to me was I got a chance to see Gill yesterday, I believe, throwing in the bullpen. Yeah, yesterday we were here early and we were looking at all the teams. He pitched a bullpen yesterday to bring him back today and start. I don't know if he would be as sharp as he would if he'd been going on his normal rotation.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just what we're guessing at. Maybe something was wrong with Alex Santos. I don't know. We'll have to get the word on that from Dave Ryan running around down there.
Absolutely. This sets it up for Justin Berg, the designated hitter, 315 average on the year. Fastball goes after the first pitch and fouls it away. Santos, who was the designated starter. Of course, you can't complain about Gill's record. He's 11-0 with a 3.00 earned run average. His numbers are actually better than Santos.
Yeah, it's not like you're throwing somebody out there that can't get the job done.
Another fastball for a called strike. 0-2. Berg in an immediate hole.
He's very impressive, though. And, Mike, he hasn't been able to put anybody away, though. And I think a lot of credit has to go to the Rice approach of hitting, putting the ball in play.
Inside and fisted it foul.
You know, they're showing us early that they're gonna make contact if they swing the bat.
It's amazing to watch some of these guys because they are very aggressive until they get to two strikes and then they become extremely disciplined. Just missed outside corner at the knees.
Well, I'm really impressed with how Gill is able to go inside and outside with the fastball. There's guys in the big leagues that can't go inside with their fastball effectively as he has. And his pitch count's getting up there already, Mike.
That's 33. Berg has been a good hitter in the clutch and a good hitter when he's gotten behind. This one's inside. Will be 2-2. He was drafted by the Cardinals as a catcher, although he hasn't caught in a couple of years because of bad knees. So Gill would like nothing better than a double play ball. Outside corner, chop towards second. They get one on to first. Not in time and the run scores. Having to wait on the second hop by Chris Clute at second base was what gave Berg the chance to beat it out.
You're absolutely right. And once he waited back and went with the conventional underhand flip, that allowed the runner to get on heel and also for Berg to get down the line. Now watch, here's what you're talking about, Mike. He waits back on this ball instead of going and getting it maybe a half a step sooner. That would have gave the opportunity for the exchange to take place and get the double play. This young man just running hard the whole way. You got an RBI on the line.
Fielder's choice and a run batted in, and it's 2-0 with two out. Runners at first and third. The seventh man to bat in the inning is Jacob Baker, the first baseman. 322 average on the season. And David Gill misses outside for a ball.
So Gill got the ground ball he was looking for, though, Mike. You called that almost as if you knew it was coming.
Well, the situation just seemed to be right. He wants to put it in play, and they want a ground ball double play opportunity. Big cut, missed on a fastball.
Probably the biggest swing we've seen today from one of the Rice hitters. Got him a 1-0 pitch, and you go ahead and try to crank on something 1-0.
Big kid, too. 6'3", 220. They said they've stayed out of a lot of fights this year because people get a good look at Jacob Baker and don't want any part of him. Just missed with a fastball.
A big kid, but if they knew what kind of heart he had, they wouldn't be worried about it. One of the nicest, kindest kids that got a chance to spend time with.
The idea in a fight is to go find the second baseman, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. Go get the little guy.
Fastball foul back out of play. 2-2. Will Ford is down at third. He had a two-base hit, the big hit of this inning. And Justin Berg got an RBI and a fielder's choice. He's at first. The 40th pitch coming of the inning for starter David Gill.
Wow. That's exactly what they wanted to do. They wanted to get deep in count.
Swung on a high fastball and struck him out. Baker goes down on strikes. But Rice makes some noise in the first inning. They put two on the board. It's our opportunity to check in with Dave Ryan. Dave.
talked so much as you and Harold have mentioned tonight already. Lazar Collazo, the Miami pitching coach, woke up this morning with a gut feeling at the team hotel for the Hurricanes that starting David Gill over Alex Santos was the thing to do. No sophisticated computer matchup, at-bat, head-to-head, nothing like that. Just pure instinct alone. Pretty good start for him anyway. As it turns out, it happened once before, back on April 17th when they took on their arch-rival Florida State. Santos was supposed to start on a Saturday. Instead, they flip-flopped David Gill and Santos on their starts, and it worked out pretty well because David Gill started a five-game win streak against Florida State, and since then, guys, he has not lost a game. He's 11-0 this year, 8-0 since that weekend back in April. Looks like it's worked so far. Lazar's good feelings anyway.
Got to be a pretty good guy when you go with an undefeated pitcher. Let's take a look at the Miami starting lineup as they come to bat in the bottom of the first. Bobby Hill will lead it off, 378 on the season. Brian Seaver, the center fielder, hits second. Manny Crespo, the right fielder, in the number three slot. Lolly Escoville, the third baseman, is the cleanup man. Kevin Brown, the leading power guy with 20 home runs, bats fifth and plays first base. Mike Rodriguez in left. Greg Lovelady is the catcher. Mark Walker, the designated hitter, and Chris Klute at second base.
Well, you talked about Mr. Brown there being the power hitter on the club. Now, this team is not designed for power, but you got to have one guy. You remember the St. Louis Cardinal teams when they had all the little rabbits and they had Jack Clark in the middle? That's kind of Brown's role in this team.
Mario Ramos, 13-2 this year with a sparkling 2.42 earned run average. Struck out 142, walked only 44. In 148 and two-thirds innings. And the innings pitched a school record. And Wayne Graham says it's not like this kid has thrown too many pitches this year. They have been playing for such a long time, those innings just start to mount up after a while.
Yeah, they started playing back in January, so he stretched his innings out over the course of the season. This is one of those pitchers now that you will probably end up seeing in the big league someday. He's got that kind of ability. Fastball, he'll move it in and out, throw you the changeup.
Hill takes a strike. This is definitely a kid you will see in the major leagues. A 378 hitter with 9 home runs. Played the last 5 or 6 weeks with a groin pull.
Yeah, and that's one of the toughest things for a middle infielder to play with. A groin pull or anything like that takes you away from your game because you play defense with your legs.
1-2, foul back out of play. Our colleague Gary Miller points out that Ramos warmed up, was ready, and goes back to the dugout, and because it took so long, he had to get down to the bullpen and warm up all over again.
Loose again.
Off the fist, and that twist back toward the stands down the right field line.
So I guess he would rather go back and know that he's got 2 runs and get loose again.
Absolutely.
Than have to go out there warmed up the first time and have nothing.
One of the keys to Miami's offense is to get Bobby Hill on base because he is the career stolen base champion. 137 steals for his career. 50 this year. That was close. It's 3-2. So when Hill gets on, there's a lot of buttons to push. Tapped right back over the mound and through. A seeing eye bouncer and a base hit for the leadoff man, Bobby Hill.
Well, Mike, we're building a great theme here with all the hitters. Make contact and you give yourself a chance. If you don't swing the bat to make contact, you don't give yourself a chance. See, Bobby Hill doesn't try to do too much, but yet he hits it perfectly back up the middle. The ball was away, he was leaning out over it, but he made contact.
Hill down at first, not going on the first pitch to Brian Seaver, another speed guy, and we'll see what Miami chooses to do. Down 2-0 in the first. I mean, they will do anything. Hit and run, run and hit, straight steals.
Well, Ramos has already given Hill 2 different looks right there. The first time he gave him a slide step, that time lifted his leg, came over. So this is going to be an interesting little cat and mouse game that he plays with him right there. Nice pickup move.
Picked
got
him
it.
Off. Doesn't pick off many this year until now. He had done it so much as a freshman and sophomore, his reputation was carrying him this year, but he froze Bobby Hill and picked him clean.
Well, one of the toughest things when you've never seen a pitcher, you don't want to run on a left-hander until you've at least seen his move one time. Here he just gives him a nice basic hesitation. Now, he set it up the time before with the throw over, and then right there caught Bobby Hill leaning. I don't even know if he was running on that play. He just caught him leaning.
Oh, we said one of the keys for Miami was to get Bobby Hill on base. One of the keys for Ramos is to get him off, and he did.
Yes, he did.
You can just, two strikes to
you can just see the momentum that Rice is playing with right now, the confidence. You can feel it.
Popped up on the infield might be a play for Baker over near the tarp and back a couple of rows.
I doubt if Bobby Hill's seen a move quite like that. That was a nice pickoff move. He waited a long time, gave him a good hesitation.
And the next time Hill is on, he's not going to have as big a lead as he did that time.
Don't think so.
The 1-2 just got a piece of it.
Looks like it caught the home plate umpire. He's going to take a little breather and just go ahead and knock some imaginary dirt off the plate. Get his bearings.
Dan Peterson had his sinuses cleared with that one.
Whew. Dan, you all right?
He's ready.
Called strike three on a fastball at the knees. First strikeout for Ramos. Two out and nobody on.
Great mechanics. You see how out of the corner of his eye picks up the plate. Look at the follow through. Just comes out in great position. Picked up his target and just drilled it. Good movement on that ball.
Manny Crespo stands in, the veteran outfielder. 362 this season with 12 home runs. Another guy who can steal a base for you. Off speed. Caught him way out ahead of that one. Crespo stockily built. Looks like he wanted a bunt, but takes called strike two instead.
Now, he broke his hand earlier in the season, so he missed part of the year, but he was a second baseman last year here in the World Series. He played second base, and the sore hand is moving to the outfield.
He was having a tremendous season before he broke that bone in his hand. Still, after missing a month, he's number two on the team in RBIs with 52. He was just driving in two a game before he got hurt. Cut it a high fastball and couldn't get it. Two strikeouts in the inning and a pickoff after a base hit. A nice start for Mariel Ramos. End of one. Rice leads Miami 2-0.
Due to a track fire, this train will be temporarily delayed.
I'll see you in a little while. Oh, is that your hand? Sorry.
Now I'm a believer. A trace of doubt in my mind. I've been alone. I'm a believer. I couldn't hurt if I tried.
I was sound. You gotta hear this.
Hook me up. Got a date. I better call.
Got change.
Change?
Dial 1-800-C-A-L-L-A-T-T and call her collect. You pay one low rate all the time.
That's called the half bro. The guaranteed cheap way to call collect.
Today there are over 300 Red Roof Inns. We've renovated our rooms, brighter colors, better fixtures, but kept our rates as affordable as ever. How do we do it?
Cheap commercials. Call 1-800-THE-ROOF and save money like you mean it.
ESPN's presentation of the NCAA College World Series is brought to you by Red Roof Inns. For reservations, call 1-800-THE-ROOF.
We're back at the College World Series in Omaha, Nebraska. Mike Patrick, Harold Reynolds with you. Dave Ryan roaming the stands. And our entire ESPN crew along the way for the number one seed in the tournament against the number one team in the country. And Rice not too happy about its seeding, although here at the tournament, the seeding really doesn't mean a whole heck of a lot. We've seen that through history. But how does the number one team in the country become the number eight seed in the tournament? Here's one smoke to right center. Seaver got there. Seaver chased down a shot off the bat of Zane Curry. He gets a great jump on the ball and then the speed to run it down.
That was a great catch, and you saw that Manny Crespo is an infielder playing the outfield. So Seaver already knows, I got to go get everything. You see him peek right there, and he's going to go get it, and Manny says, I'm not even near this ball. So you go ahead and go get it. See, Crespo is a second baseman they put out in the outfield because he's such a great offensive player. So he's able to work himself back. They're going to leave him in right. With a center fielder like that, you can afford to.
And a center fielder used to be so much more important here in Omaha before they moved the fences in about 30 feet. It was Death Valley in center field. You had to have somebody with Seaver speed playing here. You didn't have a chance. The number nine man, Matt Fox, the third baseman, stands in with one out and nobody on here in the Rice second inning.
A lot of teams would tailor their ball clubs to come to Omaha. Now the stadium's changed. They've messed up a few clubs' philosophy for a while.
Of course, LSU went to Gorilla Ball, and that certainly worked.
Yes, indeed.
And Miami was of the same make, a team that used to play little ball all the time. They had Pat Burrell and guys like that who could really launch them. But now with injuries and graduations, they are back to playing small ball again in a ballpark that favors the home run. Bounce toward third. Esquivel across his body, and there's two gone.
Excellent job of squaring his body up and fielding this ball and making the play. A lot of times you'll see third basemen take the wrong angle. They'll take an angle towards the third base dugout instead of towards home plate. He set himself at home plate and made the nice flip-off balance to get the runner.
Two out, nobody on for the leadoff man, Charles Williams, who started the game by striking out on a called third strike from David Gill. That one's a little high, 2-0. Another one of these Rice players is Williams with his priorities in order. And when you have to have around 1,600 on your college boards to get in the first place, you probably had your priorities right for a long time.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a pretty disciplined kid to have that.
We had a room full of guys at our production meeting this morning. We were trying to get up to 1,600 between us.
You got that right. I know that would have crossed me out of an opportunity to go there in a heartbeat.
Third walk issued by Gill. And brings up Smith, who walked in the first inning. So Gill has walked three, struck out two, and given up a pair of hits.
Now Rice doesn't like to run. Coach Graham doesn't like to take the bat out of his hitter's hands, but with the high leg kick that Gill has displayed, maybe he will cut Williams loose, who has the ability to steal bases. He said this morning, if I let him run, he's still 30, no problem.
He's only run 13 times this year, been successful 10 of them. Wayne Graham doesn't want to run against anybody who's going to throw him out. He said 75% is where he wants to be. And if you can steal 75%, you're doing just fine.
Oh, yeah.
Just got back. It looked like Williams got his hand stuck in the dirt reaching for the bag.
Another look. You're right, Mike. He just looked like he mistimed his dive and scuffling to get back.
and was just fortunate not to be embarrassed that the throw got there a little quicker.
It's like diving into the pool and not quite getting there.
No, that's worse. He goes this time. Love Lighting's throw.
Oh, got it.
Looked a little high, and it looked like the tag came down late. But the second base umpire, Rich Fetchett, called him out on the steal attempt. We'll go to the bottom of the second. Rice 2, Miami nothing.
Hello, Ms. Gruber. Can I interest you in some wonderful opportunities in the stock? Ms. Gruber?
It's time for E-Trade, the number one place to invest online.
I can't believe I can get this close with an electric shaver.
The 1999 Remington Microscreen 3 gives you three things no other shaver can. Our most powerful motor, more cutting edges than any leading shaver, and three flexing microscreens. You'll say no electric shaves you closer, faster, or your money back. The Remington Microscreen 3. And men with beards, get the Remington Precision Beard and Mustache Trimmer. Designed like no other with 8 beard length settings and mustache and neckline trimmers. Precision is perfectly easy.
What a shot. How'd you do it?
With the Elf, there's nothing to it. The Elf 370Z is full of surprises, like a 3x zoom and 3 picture sizes. Have you seen all the Elves?
What a shot. From Canon.
Boy, you're sweating like crazy.
You got TV cameras all over you.
We asked the hottest pros under the sun to switch antiperspirants.
Invisible solid? What's that?
Degree Invisible Solid is body heat activated with a clear difference.
Right there. See, there's no white stuff.
Degree works hard but never shows.
You gotta be cool.
Bottom of the second, we told you Wayne Graham doesn't like to steal unless he feels he can get 75% of the runners through. It looked like he got this one through, Harold.
Well, you got a little late jump, and you see him peeking in, but, Mike, you're absolutely right. The slide, now the tag, it all looks like it's at the same time, but the throw was high. And anytime you have to come down and make the tag, it's a long ways to go. You got to just figure the guy is in there. Well, we get a little closer view than the umpire maybe even got. What do you think?
I think the foot is there before the tag is at the waist.
Yep. And that's another thing that Graham factors in, I guarantee you. Now, the umpire's going to make a mistake. Not running no more. That might be the last Rice runner running the series.
Could be. Esquivel taps it on the ground on the third baseline. Fox on the line, throws him out. One pitch, one gone.
Nice play by Fox. He does a great job of circling this ball here. And just as we talked about with the other third baseman, watch him circle this ball. He gets himself in great position. Now when you circle it, what I mean is you circle yourself, you give yourself an angle to throw, and now everything's going to be right on target. That is tremendous footwork, great play. Solid fundamentals. That's what we've been seeing in the first game and also in this game.
Kevin Brown with 20 home runs, 59 RBIs, and a .320 batting average, the first baseman.
It's a big kid right here.
Takes a called strike. It's only 6'5", 225.
Yeah, that's all. Supposed to be playing football. That's
swinging out. Not anymore. He'd be a quarterback.
Really?
2-2. Miami started the game with a seeing eye base hit from Bobby Hill. They have not had one since. Foul down the third baseline.
This kid can really pitch. He's a pitcher. Right there, you saw him change speeds again on the fastball, on a changeup right there, actually. Keeping the hitter off balance. And then busting him inside with the fastball.
Some guys just have a feel for it. They don't need pitching coaches. They don't need people to tell them how to do it. They just know how to pitch. Had a good cut at that one, fouled it straight back.
You know, most left-handers, you don't usually see pitch inside as much as he is showing. You know, they usually fade the ball away from you and
hit hard but foul into the stands past the dugout. Miami, not a tradition-rich power club. Brown only the seventh in Miami history with 20 home runs or more. And he has been the power guy for this club this year. And he lost him on ball four. First walk issued by Ramos. Who had given up only 44 in 148 two-thirds innings. And that brings up the lefty, Mike Rodriguez. And let's see what kind of action Miami will put on with this one. Brown down at first, not much of a base-stealing threat. He's only stolen four this year and four tries.
Yeah, after he sees Bobby Hill get picked off, I doubt if he gets any kind of lead at all. He was jumping back as soon as Ramos lifted his leg.
Well, you don't ever know, do you?
It was so funny because he hopped off the base and he was trying to play with him, a little froggy. And then Ramos said, oh, you want a little bit of this? Okay. See him playing with him. Oh! Better get back.
Adam leaning. This one's on the corner inside for a strike. 1-1 to Rodriguez with Brown at first and one gone here in the Miami second inning. Breaking ball stopped by Zane Curry, the catcher who got it on the meat hand. Curry works well with Ramos. He's a smart receiver, handles all the pitchers well.
Now, the one thing you're seeing with Ramos and Curry is neither one of them are looking in the dugout for signs. They're calling the game.
Just that time with a fastball, 3-1.
Right there, he looked in a little bit. 3-1 is probably throw a fastball.
Well, they've corrected the count to 2-2. And that one's fouled off. Sun trying to peek through here in Omaha as we approach 7:20 local time, about an hour more of natural illumination to go. Another pickoff move. And Brown goes back on his belly.
We've been real fortunate today because coming into the day, we were kind of worried about maybe not even getting this game in.
Looks like he got him up on the shoulder.
Looks like he didn't even see that ball. He didn't even react.
He did not.
It's a good thing it hit him in the shoulder because Rodriguez didn't even react. I don't know if he's looking for a breaking ball or what, but it's a good thing it hit him where it hit him. He's frozen. Sometimes when that ball is right at you, you don't know if you should go back or go forward.
That is the 12th man this year that Ramos has plunked. And now with a walk and a hit battery, has runners at first and second with one out for Greg Lovelady, who is one of the remarkable stories of this Miami team this year. Kid who was a walk-on who hit 190 in high school. And right now, Jim Morris says he is unconscious. I don't think he got all of that one, but lifted it high to center field. Gray makes the catch. Here comes the throw to third, and the runners will advance. Lovelady, bidding for a three-run homer, gave it a ride, but short of the warning track.
Mike, here's the difference on that play that you'll see in the big leagues. As opposed to college baseball, just going to show you a little lesson here. The ball's hit the left center. He catches it. Instead of throwing that ball to second base and cutting off the tying run, he threw the ball to third base, allowing the guy on first to move up. And now a base hit's going to tie the ball game. Those are the little things you learn as you start to get older and you play more games.
Poor decision by Jason Gray, who made that throw. And you're right, he's not going to stop the guy from going to second to third, but he can prevent the runner from advancing from first. Two out, two on for Mark Walker, the designated hitter who has occasional power this year. He's hit 9 home runs, has 43 RBIs, and hitting .295 on the season. And a base hit with two out could tie it up.
That's what Coach Morris talked about. We capitalize on little things. You know, Rodriguez tagging up and going to second base right there puts him with an opportunity to tie this ball game with a base hit. Those are the little things that this Miami ball club has to do, and they do very well, obviously.
Well schooled and smart base running by Rodriguez. Just missed it as a ball and two, and Ramos wanted that one. Thought he had called strike three. Walker, a junior out of Miami. Fouled it back, one and two.
Now you look at Ramos and you think, little skinny guy, is not going to really challenge you. And he is just a bulldog.
Well, in these days of aluminum bats and smaller ballparks and hot baseballs, his earned run average of 2.42 really stands out.
And you can see why. He pitches in a just aggressive style. He'll move the ball in and move the ball out. A lot of guys, you've got to pitch inside if you want to be successful.
2-2 to Walker.
Oh, beautiful changeup.
Got it. So Ramos pitches out of a jam, strikes out Walker with runners at second and third. So Miami threatens but does not score. At the end of two, Rice leads 2-0.
Want to win an extreme vacation?
Call 1-800-C-A-L-L-A-T-T.
So how extreme is it? Dial 1-800-CALL-ATT for collect calls now, and you can win an extreme vacation of your dreams. Choose between rock climbing, surfing, heli-skiing, or riding the rapids, or win tons of other cool prizes instantly.
That's great, huh?
Call now to win.
1-800-CALLATT.
It's the same low rate every minute, every day. Dial today for your chance to win an extreme vacation. The more times you call, the more chances you have to win.
Are you with me?
Here's some food for thought. A little bit of guidance from the citizenship.
Through Sports Alliance.
When you're on the field, keep one thing in check. Be a good sport and focus on respect. Respect? That's right, ain't it a trip? It's all about teamwork and sportsmanship. When you're on the court, use your intellect and be a good sport. Focus on respect.
I'm Sed Dempsey, president of the NCAA, and I want you to focus on respect.
I'm talking about you being able to go out and achieve what you want to be able to achieve.
The leadership qualities that the people have here just go beyond what you'd expect for college students.
It's more than just leadership in athletics. I mean, I'm sure you take leadership wherever you go.
Because when it really comes down to it, the NCAA is all about us.
To the top of the third here in Omaha, Nebraska, and Rice leading Miami 2-0 in a pitcher's battle so far. What we might expect between these two ball clubs with excellent pitching staff. The prevailing wind blowing out toward right. As we have had concerns about weather, and as Harold mentioned earlier, we've gotten very lucky. Yesterday, people making all sorts of contingency plans about what if. Talking about the possibility that one or two games could be rained out.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't want that. That means 8 a.m. game, perhaps. You don't want to be calling a game at 8 in the morning, do you?
Oh, no. Oh, no. That would not have been good.
Brett Smith, who walked and scored in the first inning, leads it off.
You know,
chops it foul outside of first.
Go back to last inning with Charlie Williams getting thrown out at the end of the inning. You still start the inning off with Brett Smith coming back to plate now. He's your two-hitter who's really almost like another leadoff hitter, so that's a great situation to go ahead and run and see if you can get a guy in scoring position.
Gill has settled down after his first inning troubles. This one's chopped foul as well. The count holds at 1-2. Smith, Thames, and Ford, the scheduled hitters for the Rice Owls in this inning. Into left field, and it drops in front of Mike Rodriguez for a base hit.
Another two-out hit. Letting the ball get back in on you and just fight it off. I mean, two-strike hit. I'm sorry, I said two-out. I meant two-strike. You understood what I was talking
about. Third hit of the ball game, following the Wayne Graham philosophy. He'll let you go up there and be aggressive at the start, and then he wants you to protect the plate. And you'll see a lot of opposite field base hits with two strikes.
Mm-hmm.
Thames, who had an infield single and scored in the first, lays down the bunt. Hill off the mound. Boy, was that close.
Wow.
First base umpire Ken Couch called him out. It looked like a bang-bang play.
Well, Thames catching everybody off guard. Now, he wanted to put this down to third baseline. Gill comes over. It might have been a bare hand play. It was so close. But, Mike, I think he's there.
Boy, it looked like Thames beat it out. He'll get a sacrifice.
I mean, that's not close.
And that's the second call that these kids could legitimately question in this ballgame. I mean, think of the difference. That would have been runners at first and second with nobody out.
In the heart of your lineup coming up.
Will Ford, the cleanup guy. He had the big hit in the first inning, an RBI double. Held up on a high fastball.
Thames is probably able to break that down pretty good. Explaining that to somebody in the dugout.
2-0, Kyle back out of play. Go back to the first inning for Ford. As he sliced it down the left field line, it went for a double, and he ends up getting an RBI on the play and sends another runner to third.
Mm.
2-2. 4 to third team All-American this year and the most valuable player in the regionals. As Rice has been the number one seed in the regionals now, 2 years running. Missed with a fastball, full count to Will Ford.
He's really built a competitive program there. And I was speaking with Coach Graham yesterday about Jose Cruz Jr. He said, when I got Jose Cruz Jr., all the kids in Houston area.
Hit a long way toward deep right. Crespo going back to the track, to the wall, and it's gone. Will Ford with his 12th home run of the year.
Right there, tremendous job of hitting again, Mike. Another two-strike hit. And Coach Morris can't believe it. Now, the wind's starting to pick up, but that ball was hit pretty good anyway. Got a slider on the inside and just drove it out of the ballpark. Get a good look right here. It might have been a slider or a change or something off speed, and he got it and give it a look, but this one's back about 10 rows.
Three RBIs in the ball game for Will Ford, 73 for the season, and it's a 4-0 lead for the Rice Owls. They have put up four hits against David Gill, and he has chipped in with three bases on balls. So Jason Gray, the home run hitting leader for the Owls, stands in. An inside pitch and whacks it foul. We were talking earlier about the fact that Rice was number one in the ESPN USA Today poll, but they're the number eight seed here. That's because the NCAA relies so much on that RPI index, and the league is down this year. The WAC did not have as many stellar records as it normally does, so the RPI says that they were only the ninth best conference in the country. So Rice gets the number eight seed. And that's a nice little motivating tool for a coach.
Oh, yeah. Don't think the players aren't coming in here. Playing a number one seed the first night, get a chance to prove to everybody that you are better than the committee wanted to show you to be.
67 pitches here so far in the third inning for Gill, the starter for Miami.
The problem for Gill has not been Gill. It has been the great offensive approach of the Rice Owls. I mean, they've done a great job of fighting off two strikes. He has got ahead of every hitter to get them to two strikes, but he can't put them away because they do such a great job of making contact.
2-1 here. Took something off, and Gray swung over the top 2-2.
May as well just give him two strikes. No, Rice, just give me two strikes, and now we'll go ahead and go to work.
Or let him hit the first pitch because they're so good with two strikes. Another off-speed pitch lofted to left from Mike Rodriguez. The wind bringing it in, and Rodriguez tracks it down near the line. Two gone. Check it. That's the first out. No, it would be the second.
Because
they had the sacrifice.
Punt.
I keep thinking he was safe, even though he was called out.
I was sitting there thinking with you.
Thinking with me sometimes is not a great idea. Screamer to left. A base hit for Justin Berg.
Well, Mike, you talked about the aggressiveness of the Rice hitters, and when they get two strikes, they become more disciplined. The way you stay aggressive is you get a pitch that you're looking for the first pitch. And that's discipline. Right there, he got a pitch that he's looking for. A fastball on the inside half that I want to pull, and he got it, and he drove it in the outfield.
Lovelady set up way inside, but that one caught too much of the plate. Jacob Baker, who fanned his first time up, stands in with two out and a runner at first. A ball and no strikes to the Rice first baseman, who's averaged now at 320 for the season. Took something off and got it in for a called strike, 1-1. Here's another kid that was a very aggressive hitter when he came to Rice, and if he can control that, Wayne Graham says he is a much better hitter. And that's usually the case with anybody.
Right, it is. Hitting is, it's a science. I mean, you got to be disciplined, but aggressive, and you just learn that through at-bats, knowing what you can do.
Hit hard off the shoulder of Esquivez at third and into left field. Just ate him up on one short hop.
Well, it really did, and when you have a long inning or a lot of base runners on base, you chop up the infield. And here you are in the third inning. They're not going to drag this again until the fifth or sixth inning. You start getting a lot of base runners, that's when you start getting tricky hops, although I don't know if he would have fielded that ball anyway, Mike. That was a laser hit down there.
Now, third place is the last place you want to be anyway, I think.
Got that,
especially
right.
If the infield's a little choppy. So two hard hit balls in a row will bring up Zane Curry, the catcher, with two out. Takes it inside. Five hits allowed by Gill, and that is ruled a base hit. Would have been the toughest error you've ever seen. Give Esquivel credit. He took a swipe at it. Fouled off third.
See, they're starting to catch up to the pattern of Gill now. He's not moving the ball in and out. He's really trying to pound guys all of a sudden. The first inning, he moved the ball in and out. Even though they got two runs, they didn't hit the ball hard. Now he stayed within a pattern of trying to bust everybody inside, and they're catching up to it.
1-1 to Curry, and missed outside. How much easier was it for you to hit a guy the second time around? This is the second time through the order.
It's a lot easier, particularly if you have a good first at-bat where you see all his pitches. And hitting is nothing but familiarity. As soon as you become familiar with his pitches and what he's throwing, you're able to make the adjustments.
Right in there for a strike. That was 79 pitches for Gill, so I think everybody has seen just about everything he has so far.
Absolutely. And one thing that Rice has been able to do is put him away.
2-2 to Curry. Ripped, but foul.
You know, nothing more frustrating as a group of hitters is to get a pitcher on the ropes like you have Gill and not be able to put him away. You know, they've put four up on the board on him already.
Got a chance to add to that total right now with two out and two on here in the Rice half of the third inning. Strike three called, and Gill gets out without any further damage, but Rice puts two more on the board, and it was Ford's two-run homer to right center that was the difference. Rice takes a 4-0 lead over number one seed Miami.
The one thing you can't buy at Gallery Furniture today is a frustrating backorder slip. No backorder slips at Gallery Furniture. Buy beautiful home furniture fashions today. Gallery Furniture delivers tonight. We've got brand new inventory in the store, and we've got giant selection, giant savings, immediate financing, and immediate delivery for you. Buy your furniture today. Gallery Furniture delivers tonight. No waiting, no delay, no backorder slip. Save up to 50% off selected special purchase merchandise today. No backorder. Gallery Furniture saves you money.
Whether helping his children get an A on a spelling test or teaching them how to parallel park, Joseph A. Bank would like to pay tribute to these executives with our Father's Day sale. Up to 60% off throughout every Joseph A. Bank store. All Executive Collection wool suits now only $199.99. Spring sport coats as low as $124.99. Plus big savings on cotton fashion dress shirts, silk ties, and cotton polo shirts. That's the Joseph A. Bank Father's Day sale. Joseph A. Bank. Smart clothing. Smart customers.
Two words. Hot stock. Perfect for us.
You get a sexy portfolio that'll make you rich. Me, a small commission.
Trust me. I'm only here to make you money.
Before you go here, go here. Whether you're tracking your own stocks or the market, at Go.com, you're in charge.
If you're not talking to your kids about drugs, who do you think is?
And what do you think they're saying?
Be the voice they listen to.
Talk to your kids about drugs and alcohol. Talk, listen,
stay involved.
The Owls of Rice have staked their starter Mariel Ramos to a 4-0 lead as we go to the Miami half of the third inning here in the College World Series, an opening round game between the number one and the number eight seed. But don't let the seed fool you. Rice number one in at least one of the polls and near the top in the others. Of course, so is Miami. Florida State was the number one team much of the year. They are here as well. Seven of the eight number one seeds in the tournament made it. Ground ball to Thames, it's short, up quickly, and throws out the number nine hitter, Chris Klute.
I'll tell you, this young man right here is pretty as short. He's got the lanky body, great fundamentals and mechanics, a strong arm. You know, we're talking a lot about Bobby Hill, but I haven't seen anybody fill the ground ball as smooth as him in a long time.
Big kid is a shortstop. Of course, I see Miami on the field, and I just remember Cora a couple of years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Boy, talk about somebody who could pick it. Holy smokes.
Well, Coach Morris was talking about that earlier today. He's had Nomar Garciaparra, Cora.
At Georgia Tech.
Yeah, Cora. And now Bobby Hill, and I'm forgetting the
so am I. I can't pick the other name, but he's Metcalf. He's had a series of them.
Yes.
He was honored, by the way, the other night. The Georgia Tech inducted him into their Athletic Hall of Fame. A great honor for him, and I think it says an awful lot about Georgia Tech. In these days of competition, that a guy leaves after he's built up a program, goes to a rival program, somebody you're going to be competing against for a national championship, and you still have the class to go ahead and say, look what this guy did when he was here. Let's put him in our Hall of Fame.
Absolutely. That is to be commended.
Bobby Hill draws a walk. Remember the last time he got on with a base hit up the middle, the only hit, incidentally, off Mario Ramos. He was picked off first base. And it wasn't even close. He was standing about 15 feet from the bag.
Well, with four runs down, I doubt if he gets a big lead right here. You see he's only a couple steps off the bag.
Ryan Seaver squares around as if to bunt. Struck out his first time up.
Well, it looks like they're in that take-a-strike mode already, and that's what happens with a little small ball type of team. You want to take a strike before you start getting aggressive, trying to force Ramos into a lot of pitches and make a mistake.
That one missed 1-1. Ramos has only walked one in the ball game. And fan three. Checking throw, and you were right, Harold. Hill has a very tiny lead.
Well, you can't afford to make mistakes right now. You want to inch your way back into the ball game. And
popped up on the infield. Jacob Baker in foul territory. Two gone. Check in with Dave Ryan. What's up, Dave?
Oh, Mike, thanks a lot. For the second straight game, we had Justin Smith last time of Alabama, who's married. Same goes for Mario Ramos of Rice. This is Andrew Ramos, bride of 6 months. What's it like experiencing the College World Series with a husband on the mound here?
It's awesome. It's kind of nerve-wracking, though, but we were here 2 years ago, so we kind of know what to do. But, yeah, it's very nerve-wracking.
He was just drafted by the Oakland Athletics a couple weeks back. What's the feeling now? Is he going to sign, or what's going to happen?
I can't really say. He'd probably kill me, but he'll make the right decision.
How about Rice's chances here? The guys are very confident. They came all the way through the Super Regional at the Astrodome. Do you feel they can win this whole thing?
Oh, definitely. They're awesome. I really think they have a chance, and they're going to beat Miami.
Now, Angie, Mario told me yesterday he touches the wedding ring, which he wears around his neck as a special pendant, when he's in trouble pitching. You didn't know about this, though?
No, I knew he wore it, you know, but I never knew he touched it. I'm going to be watching to see.
Thanks a lot for joining.
Thank you.
Guys, Angie Ramos.
All right, thanks, Dave. And if your wife is watching you touch that ring for good luck, it better work when you do it.
You got that right.
1-0 to Crespo. Ripped, hooking, foul. Got out in front of a fastball.
Yeah, it looked like a little BP fastball on a 1-0 count. Now, in the college game, we talked about this before, they like to throw what they call a batting practice fastball. Instead of throwing maybe if you throw 90, instead of throwing your ball 90, you throw it about 85. And he speeded up Manny's bat and was able to catch up to it. Fortunately for Ramos, he pulled it foul. Now, the last time Crespo was up, he threw a ball right by him. So it doesn't make any sense to slow down your pitch so you can speed up his bat.
Another throw over. Hill takes his lead off first with two gone. Crespo with 12 home runs this year. There's a fastball up and in, and it's 2-1.
Does every kid in the College World Series look like Chuck Knoblauch? I mean, there was a kid this morning, Donnie Hill. Bobby Hill looks just like Chuck Knoblauch right there. Jeez.
Up and in again, 3-1.
Better start touching that ring.
It's getting to be about that time. Fastball just missed inside at the knees, and Crespo draws a walk. The second issued by Ramos. And that will get the cleanup hitter up there, Wally Esquivel. In this ballpark, three-run homers are common, and you are one swing away from being back in a one-run game.
This is a huge at-bat right here because you got the two outs and he's struggling a little bit. This might be the one time they get to him.
Strike on the outside part of the plate, right on the black.
As pitchers go through that little period and they snap back out of it and they get back in a groove again. And you want to get them when they're rocky, and this might be that one time for Miami to get him.
Two walks in the inning issued by Ramos, three overall. In the dirt, nice block by Curry. Calls an excellent game for this staff. Has a good arm, but has been erratic when he has thrown at times this year. Esquivel crowding the plate, standing tall. 1-1 count. Had a good cut, but fouled it down the third baseline. 1-2. Going to be tougher today to hit one out to left with the wind blowing about 12, 15 miles an hour to right, but you can do it.
We've seen it done. few times out.
1-2, foul back up on the roof.
Mike, we got a shot right here at the second baseman now with two outs. You want to play deep. We've discussed this before. Shortstop, second baseman, play back, knock the ball down. And a lot of times you see the second baseman or shortstop trying to hold that runner at second. If he runs, let him run. He's going to score on a base hit. Now you're giving the whole right side of the infield up for somebody to dribble a ball through.
This is hit toward the hole. Thames, quick throw to second and got him. Nice play by the shortstop. Beautifully quick release, planted, gunned, and got the force. End of three, 4-0.
The X Game. The only extreme event that matters. The X Games, June 27th to July 5th. Presented by Chevy S10.
Meet Chris Worth, animator. Knows good, knows evil. Knows that having a formidable partner is definitely good. Chevy S10, like a rock.
As the chief operating officer for Great Harvest, Tom McMakin is responsible for a lot of franchise owners' dreams.
Our highest obligation is to teach them how to run a great holy bakery. And so we link them up with other owners.
Using Microsoft software, Great Harvest owners all over the country share absolutely everything. Together, they have all the knowledge they need to run a great little bread store.
We're able to share what works. We all get smarter that much quicker.
Thames with that fine defensive play to end the Miami third inning as we go to the top of the fourth. And take a look at it again.
Well, Mike, he does some great things. Now, there's no wasted motion. Just gets back and look at the gracefulness. But he gets rid of the ball, and that's the key. Got back, got rid of it quick. And also with two outs, you play deep. But that comes with taking a lot of ground balls and a lot of extra work. And you can tell a senior from a freshman ball player because he's able to eliminate a lot of extra motion. And he will do nothing but get better.
Zane Curry, the number eight man in the order, leads it off in the Rice fourth inning. They're up 4-0 against David Gill.
They can say what they want, but in the 2 years I've been to the College World Series, he's the best shortstop I've seen. Taking ground balls and spending time with kids. He's right up there.
You think he's as good as Cora?
I didn't see Cora.
That's right.
I wasn't here that year.
Because I got to go back a long way to see somebody that I thought was as good as Cora.
He is a good one. Well, that's why he's a big league player, too.
Hit on the ground towards second. Klute with an easy play and throws him out, one guy. College World Series continues tomorrow. Opening games from the second bracket. Texas A&M will face second-seeded Florida State. You can see that on CBS in the afternoon. Then at 8 Eastern, Cal State Fullerton taking on the Stanford Cardinal on ESPN2. Earlier today in bracket 1, Alabama defeated Oklahoma State. In this double elimination tournament, the winner of this game takes on Alabama. Tonight's loser will go against Oklahoma State. Matt Fox, the third baseman who is officially 0-for-1, stands in. Oh, check it, we're Charles Williams.
Well, Williams has not seen a ball in the inside half all day. They've been painting him hard outside. So evidently, that's the book that they have on him. They want to try to pitch him away. Got one in there.
Straight back. Incoming. And as opposed to Joe Morgan, my partner Harold Reynolds went for it.
I tried to catch it. I was right there and didn't quite make it.
I, on the other hand, ducked behind my trusty monitor. With the pitch count rising on Gill, the Miami bullpen in action. Prendis and Roberson are out there. And he loses Williams to another walk.
We'll see how Mr. Graham plays it this time around. Think he'll let him run again?
I think with a 4-0 lead, he might give it a shot. 88 pitches so far through 3 1/3 for David Gill, getting precariously close to the normal pitch count to take him out of the game. Swung over the top of an off-speed pitch to Brett Smith, who has a walk and a base hit so far.
Well, Rice just keeps coming at you. They just keep getting runners on and keep the pressure on.
Ooh. Smoked into right field. Crespo comes up, throwing, and Charles Williams will hold on at second base. But a 2-for-2 afternoon for Brett Smith.
Nice piece of hitting right there. You're left-handed hitter with a runner on first base. You're looking to shoot this ball to the right side. You want to pitch inside to try to shoot it through that four hole, because the first baseman is holding. It gives you more ground to shoot the ball through. Got to pitch inside and drove it into right.
And now the dangerous Damon Thames comes up with runners at first and second and one out.
Thames, no gloves, no batting gloves, doesn't make mistakes. There's always one guy like that, you know, that Joe DiMaggio type that doesn't make any mistakes.
Leads this team in doubles, stolen base percentage. Only a sophomore after that brilliant freshman year when the Coaches Association named him the National Player of the Year. All he did was hit .424 with 26 home runs and 115 RBIs. And we're talking about 115 RBIs in 70 games.
Yeah, this isn't a 162-game schedule. That's doing some raking right there. Some damage.
Gill ahead in the count, 0-2.
You know who he reminds me of? I'm going to throw this at you.
All right.
Roy Smalley.
Okay.
Doesn't he have that little Roy Smalley stance from the right side?
I can see
that.
You
know, Roy was a switch hitter, but he's got the Roy Smalley in him.
I think he'd take Roy Smalley's career right now.
Oh, yeah. Good hit.
Line right at the second baseman Plute. They go to short. Bobby Hill gets the double play. So hit hard by Thames, but it results in a 4-6 double play. Miami out of the inning. We go to the bottom of the fourth. Still 4-0 Rice.
Boy, you're sweating like crazy.
You got TV cameras all over you.
We asked the hottest pros under the sun to switch antiperspirant.
Invisible Solid? What's that?
Degree Invisible Solid is body heat activated with a clear difference.
Right there. See, there's no white stuff.
Degree works hard but never shows.
You gotta be cool.
This is the sale of the century. Nobody works the numbers like me. Honest, Bob. Tax, license, wheels not included. Heck, nothing's included. Come on down and spend your hard-earned cash today.
Before you go here, go here. Whether you're comparing prices or options, at go.com, you're in the driver's seat.
Okay, people, this is a phone, and this is a dollar. You still with me? Well, that's good. Now dial this number, and all your long-distance calls from home could cost less than a buck. That's right, with 1010-220, all calls up to 20 minutes are only 99 cents. Talk longer, and it's just 10 cents for each extra minute. No fees, no contracts. Am I right, Poochie? Just dial 1010-220, then 1, then the number. Bottom line, you get up to 20 minutes on this for less than this. You got that? Good, because if I'm not mistaken, I think nature's calling my dog.
Every year they seem to make another spectacular addition to this beautiful ballpark, Rosenblatt Stadium. This year it's a plaza-like atmosphere out in front with a gorgeous statue. And they just continue to refine this ballpark, and it is one of the finest facilities anywhere in the country. It is just absolutely magnificent. And yeah, you can raise your cholesterol a couple hundred points in a quick afternoon.
Food's not bad either. I was just going to say that.
Where dreams come true, and it has for so many players and so many teams. Eight enter the College World Series this year, the last of the millennium, hoping to go out with that championship trophy. And right now, Rice in its opening game with Miami with a 4-0 lead as we go to the bottom of the fourth. Ramos has given up only one base hit. He's walked three and hit a batter, but has allowed no runs.
Well, he really struggled through last inning, so now I think he got through his rough period. A big pitch right there to go ahead and get ahead of the first hitter.
Kevin Brown leads it off, a fastball low. Brown walked his first time up. He's hitting 320 this season. 6'5", 225 out of North Fort Myers, Florida. Got out in front of that one and tapped it foul. Curry pounced on it, but couldn't make a play.
Well, the one thing you're going to see these opening round games, you are going to see some good pitching. Because everybody's going to come at you with their best. So hitters aren't accustomed to seeing the great stuff. You will get a chance to see where you stack up.
Ripped right at the shortstop vein. Made it look easy.
Got a great jump on that ball. Anticipation is the key. As a middle infielder, particularly a shortstop, you know what pitch is going to be thrown, so you can already start to adjust where you think the ball might be hit. And he does a great job. As you see him come into the picture, he's already moving. So great job of anticipating, and that comes with knowing your pitcher also, what pitches he will throw in certain situations. So these two playing a long time with each other, he had an idea where he might try to locate that pitch.
And that baby had some overspin on it too.
Yeah, it did.
So Brown hits it hard, but is the first out here in the fourth, and Mike Rodriguez, who was hit in the shoulder close to being behind him his first time up.
Yeah, it really didn't look like he saw that ball coming out of his hand there. It didn't have much of a reaction.
Well, the ones that are inside, you're so used to being able to get out of the way, but if the ball starts going a little bit behind you, you just tend to freeze.
Yeah.
And that's not good.
No, that's not good at all. Especially when they're coming 90 miles an hour.
1-2, breaking ball, lofted to right. Ford comes on, has room, and makes the catch. Angie Ramos watching her husband spin a one-hitter here in the fourth. Hasn't had to touch that ring too many times.
Having a good time. It's always nice when you're winning.
Oh, it's the best.
You yanked that mic off, they start to lose.
Greg Lovelady stands in with two out and nobody on for the Hurricanes.
I mean, he's what college baseball is all about, Mike.
Unbelievable, a kid that hits 190 in high school, a couple of years later ends up being the starting catcher in the College World Series. Of course, one of the reasons, Russ Jacobson, who was the best hitter the Hurricanes had, a 360 average and 14 home runs, is injured and out for the year. It's the reason Lovelady got his chance earlier in the season when Jacobson first got hurt. He got in and played. There's Jacobson. He was hit by a pitch and fractured his arm. And they really miss him.
Well, they miss that power in the lineup.
Absolutely.
They need another guy in the lineup with the pop.
But Lovelady has just shocked everybody, hitting 345. Mike Morris says with a bat in his hand, he's just been unconscious. There was a streak of three games on a road trip. Three straight games, he had the game-winning hit.
Hit to play.
Hit toward the hole. Nice stop by Fox. Throws high, but Baker gets down in time. Ramos, three up, three down. His first perfect inning. We played four in Omaha. 4-0, Rice.
I'll see you.
Hi, man.
Me too.
Me too?
Ah, the credit card game. We've all played it.
I'll go 5.9%.
That an intro rate?
Yeah.
First, you get a great introductory rate, but then it goes up.
So you'll raise us to 17.9% in 6 months?
Yeah.
But now, if you have good credit, you can win the credit card game by calling 1-800-424-9977.
Let's make it interesting.
I'm out. I'll call.
With the 9.9% fixed rate Visa Platinum card from Capital One.
Fixed? That's a great hand.
It's not an introductory rate. You get a low fixed rate you can trust, platinum perks, and no annual fee. Act now. Call 1-800-424-9977. Transfer your high interest balances to the 9.9% fixed rate Visa Platinum from Capital One and save hundreds, even thousands of dollars a year. Call 1-800-424-9977 and win the credit card game.
I worry too much. Merging two bank networks. But it wasn't a problem. AT&T nailed that. They really helped us connect our customers, trading partners. And everyone's together in real time. Now we can give service on demand. Very cool. Our revenue is going to go sky high. I like worrying about that.
AT&T Net.Working to make your business succeed.
Greg Lovelady just coming out of the dugout after getting his gear on. And we told you, replacing Russ Jacobson, the big hitter. And let's go down to Dave Ryan. He's with Russ right now.
All right, Mike. Thanks very much, Russ. It can't be easy to watch this. I know you arrived from your native Scottsdale, Arizona today, flew in this afternoon, and now you're with the injured arm. You got to kind of watch it. It can't be too easy, especially the team trailing 4-0.
It's real hard to watch this. You know, I'm pulling for him all the way, but, you know, when you work all year from the beginning to be here, and then all of a sudden you're hurt and you can't play, it hurts a lot.
Mike and Harold talked a lot about the job Greg Lovelady has done in replacing you. What has that been like to watch him, and have you helped him a lot?
It's good to watch him. You know, it's really good that, so fortunately, our team, you know, guys have been getting hurt all year, and guys have been stepping it up, and Greg's done a good job stepping it up, and he's doing well.
Thanks a lot for joining us. See you up soon, okay?
All right.
Guys, third-round draft pick, Philadelphia Phillies. Looking forward to playing the big league someday.
All right, Dave, thanks very much. And Russ, good luck to you. It's a shame to have a season ended that way. The Miami Post-Herald talking about all the guys that were hurt this year, and Dave just mentioned that people step up. There's a limit to that. You can only lose so many guys so many times before you can't plug the holes anymore.
You're absolutely right. It shows the depth of the program, but the program can only be so deep. The other thing that hits Miami is the draft. You know, they have a lot of high school players that they go out, they sign, and as Jim Morris is saying, I don't even know if they're going to show up because they had three kids going the first round this year. So they're not coming to school next year. Now that's three more people he's got to go out and try to replace. Tough job, but hey, it's not that tough coming back to the World Series every year.
That's right.
It's worth it.
And every year is for sure. Will Ford, who had a two-run homer and a double in the ballgame, leads it off, and fans. So Ford, 2-for-3. Hope you'll join ESPN this Monday at 7:30. You get to see the number one draft pick, Shamiqua Holdsclaw, leading the Mystics against Tarifa Witherspoon and the New York Liberty in a WNBA matchup. Monday night at 7:30 right here on ESPN. Holdsclaw had 18 points in her debut last night against Houston. She is the real deal. I got to see her every year at Tennessee, and she is just a magnificent player and a terrific kid.
She's fun to watch. And you said it right. She's a good person, too. But she is fun to watch. Man.
And she's shooting them up in the WNBA just the way she did in college. She is a player. Jason Gray stands in. Nobody on. One out here in the fifth. Rice holding a 4-0 lead. Gill continues on the mound for the Hurricanes. Now throwing 101 pitches, giving up 7 hits and 4 runs. This one's fouled out of play. Gray batting in the fifth slot, most of the year hitting the number 2, and moving down to 50s, raised his average quite a bit this month. Sometimes guys just feel more comfortable in different spots in the batting order. Really doesn't make any sense. There's no logic to it, but it just is.
Yeah, it depends on how they pitch you, too, but moving from the two spot to the five spot, I think I wouldn't mind sitting in the two slot. You know, Thames sitting behind me and Williams in front of me.
This one is hit hard on the ground past the diving second baseman, Chris Klute.
But you're right, Mike. Sometimes it doesn't make any sense. And once again, he makes gets a base hit out of not making a whole lot of sense. Right here, he stays with a breaking ball and just stays right through it. Good follow through. That's why he's able to drive that ball. But you can see, even at the approach thinking the other way, once again, Rice continues to have that philosophy with two strikes getting base hits.
Well, Mr. Spock once said, it is not logical, but you will find it is true. And I have always followed his philosophy.
Yes, indeed. Trekkie fans out there understand that.
Justin Berg takes a called strike. You would think this would be the last inning for Gill if he can get out of the fifth without further trouble, and he may. Hill to Klute, and thrown to first and dropped by Kevin Brown. So Berg reaches to keep the inning alive.
Well, they got the ground ball. Now watch Hill right here. He knows where he's going, but he follows his feed. That's why it continues to be a strong feed to the second baseman. He rushed himself a little bit. He had more time than he actually thought, and that's why he made a bad throw. But Bobby Hill got the ball to him. I want to call him Hill. Bobby Hill got the ball to him so quick, he didn't have to rush as much as he did.
And Brown couldn't come up with a throw.
I want to keep calling Hill Donnie Hill. You know, and then I say Bobby Hill. I say it right, and I'm still thinking I'm supposed to say Donnie Hill.
Baker is one for two, single and a strikeout on his night. Foul back over the roof, 0-2.
So another interesting thing about Miami is we heard from the catcher, Jacobson, who's from Scottsdale, Arizona. Hill's from San Jose, California. I mean, they come from all over to go to the University of Miami and play baseball.
They know where Coral Gables is. Lined into right. Berg is on his way to third. He'll make it easily.
Well, I don't know how many times we got to say this all night, but that was a great piece of hitting on another two-strike approach. Here's a big hitter now. He takes the ball, stays inside out of it, not trying to do too much. This is your power guy. Staying with the philosophy. Watch him pull his hands through and just fight that ball off with two strikes and give yourself a chance to get a hit.
That'll give Zane Curry a chance to increase the lead with runners at first and third and two out. Ed's been a clinic talking to Rice's head coach this morning. Wayne Graham was talking about his philosophy, and you're watching his kids execute it beautifully in this game.
Yeah, it's got to be nice to the coach to see him execute your plan when you've taught it all year.
And you only have to do it a couple of times. Once you find out it works, then players buy into it big time. Doesn't hurt your batting average either.
No, it really doesn't. Well, success is the key. You know, if you're successful at anything, players are going to do that.
Gill losing a little bit on his fastball. It was clocked at 91 miles an hour in the first inning, now down to 86. And these guys will turn on an 86 mile an hour fastball.
Sure will. Not going to be as effective getting that ball inside. Also, that comes with fatigue. You know, this is late in the year. These kids have been playing a lot of baseball since really January. And it's June now, and they're probably playing more baseball than they ever have in their whole lives.
2-1 is inside. Three balls and a strike to Zane Curry. Lined out and struck out in this ball game. Hit back up the middle off the fist. Hill has to play it on the hop and throws him out.
Pretty.
Bobby Hill with a nice play at short. The threat dies with runners at first and third, but still 4-0 Rice.
his children get an A on a spelling test or teaching them how to parallel park, Joseph A. Bank would like to pay tribute to these executives with our Father's Day sale. Up to 60% off throughout every Joseph A. Bank store. Spring sport coats as low as $124.99. And all executive collection wool suits now only $199.99. Plus big savings on cotton fashion dress shirts, silk ties, and cotton polo shirts. That's the Joseph A. Bank Father's Day sale. Joseph A. Bank. Smart clothing. Smart customers.
Rosenblatt Stadium in Omaha, it just gets better every single year. I can't think of a better experience. You have a chance to see a minor league game, to come to this ballpark, which rivals a lot of major league facilities I've seen. This yeah. place is just beautiful.
The people are great, too. You know, that's what makes the atmosphere. Is all the fans that come out, you talked about that in the open, 80% of the crowd is local.
Never seen a place that welcomed an event with such open arms, sincere warmth and hospitality, and they come out to root for good baseball. And sometime during this series, they will pick their favorites, maybe an underdog that's doing well or a team with some regional interest. But on the whole, they just root for everybody. They want to see good ball games, tremendous opening day crowd here again. We set records year after year, even with inclement weather. And fortunately, it has held off for us this year. First pitch to Mark Walker, leading off the Miami fifth, hit back foul, out of play. A one-hitter so far for Mario Ramos. Walker, one of his strikeout victims in his first at-bat.
If you go back to the one-hitter he had with two strikes, with two outs, and we were talking about this is the pivotal point of the game for him right here, and he has been on a roll ever since. Got through that hitter and up to last inning, here he is.
The 0-2 misses inside. And Ramos works quickly, which is something the players behind him really appreciate.
That's one reason there's no errors in this game. Both pitchers have worked extremely fast.
Strike three called, and for the second time, Mark Walker, a strikeout victim.
The other thing that happens when you work fast as a pitcher, the umpire stays in the game. And you're going to have a tendency to get pitches that are close because you keep the game moving. He wants to keep the game moving.
Good point. Chris Klute, who grounded a short, his only time up in this game, the number nine hitter stands in. And there has to be a little sense of desperation starting to sink in that Miami dugout. Again, this is not a team that normally puts together big innings for you. They got to manufacture runs, sacrifice bunts, hits.
And this is the worst kind of pitcher to have to do this against because you play into his hand. You know, he wants you to put the ball in play and hit the ball on the ground for me. Do those things that I need. She's thinking he got another punch out there. You look at his wife for it. She knows what a strikeout looks like.
Ramos has not given up a hit since Bobby Hill led off the ball game with a bouncer back up the middle. And there have been very few hard hit balls off this left hand.
Done a great job of mixing his pitches and keeping the hitters off balance. Hard, soft, busting them in and out. He's not only gone hard and soft, but going in and out is important too.
Absolutely. Klute is hitting 10 of his last 11 ball games. He's been a pleasant surprise for this team. Baker giving chase and just short of getting there. Back in the first row of seats. We talked about how long these kids have been playing ball this year in the great southern programs like Miami. Well, Klute didn't have a base hit until the 27th of February. Not one. And he has raised his average since then to 309 coming into the College World Series. You don't think that's frustrating?
Wow. 27th inside. Of February, I'm thinking about the teams in the Northwest where I grew up at. They haven't even played their first game yet.
No.
Haven't had a chance to get there.
Well, they haven't shoveled the driveway yet. Lost in ball four. Good job by Klute to hang in there and spoil a couple. Four walks charged to Ramos. Sports Century's countdown of the top 50 North American athletes of the past century continues tonight at 10:30 on ESPN. with one of my favorites, number 32, Johnny Unitas, the Baltimore Colt legend, the NFL Player of the Year three times, a 10-time Pro Bowler, elected to the Hall of Fame in 79. He had more guts than anybody who's played this game in a long, long time. For more on John Unitas, you can check into ESPN.com, part of the Go Network, Go.com. I had players tell me who played against him that he would hold the ball a fraction of a second longer than he had to so you could get a good lick at him, because he was going to show you it didn't matter. He was going to get up the next time. You could take another best shot that you had. And remember, quarterbacks weren't protected then. No. They were fair game for anybody and anything. He was magnificent. Long drive left center field. Williams going back to the wall. And it's gone. Williams is complaining to the umpire. But that ball hit by Bobby Hill against the wind just kept going. Bobby Hill has the only two hits in the ball game. And that was his 10th home run to get Miami right back in it.
Well, I was talking to Bobby yesterday. I was kind of playing around with him. I said, look at you, big guy. You went and yoked up. You got stronger. And right here, he hits this ball last year. It's not going out. Right there, he gave us a sight that it was a no-doubter. Now, let's see what happens here, what they're arguing about.
Oh, that's why Charles Williams wants a beef. The fan way over the fence. Harold, that's not a home run.
No, it's not a home run. The shame of it is that the umpire didn't even go out. You know, you get caught up in watching the game, but you got to go out and see if that ball's going to make it out or not.
This one is bounced through the right side for a base hit for Seaver. Back-to-back hits.
Just like that, Wayne Graham says, it's time for me to have a little conversation.
Now take a look at the fan interference. On the replay, you're going to see how obvious this was as Wayne Graham wants to come out and talk to his pitcher.
That ball, it might make it into the stands. What do you think?
I don't think so.
No.
At best, that's going to hit the wall.
Hit the wall.
On the top.
Somebody called him from home and said, hey, man, you're messing up the game.
And that would be a ground rule double. That was good.
Yeah. Great camera work, gentlemen.
That's the responsibility of Tim Norman, the third base umpire, as he chases it out toward left field. Because that's got to be the toughest call an umpire can make.
It's got to be. You know, you got the yellow line out there, but if you get out, you give yourself a better chance. So even if you miss it, but you're in right position, nobody's going to complain. If you don't get out there, then that's when you get the complaints.
Nichols and Gwynn are warming in the bullpen.
Got ourselves a ball game, Mike.
Miami right back in it on the two-run dinger.
With a guy at the plate that can actually juice one.
Crespo stands in, one swing away from a tie. Only three hits allowed by Ramos, but won a two-run homer in this inning.
And Manny grew up with the batting cage in the backyard. His dad was a hitting coach with the Marlins. He knows a little bit about situational hitting.
He has walked and struck out in this ball game. There was a great moment for he and his dad earlier this year when the Marlins played in Coral Gables in an exhibition game, and father and son got to come out and exchange the lineup cards.
Oh, that is great.
That's cool.
Yeah, it is.
One and one to Manny Crespo. A runner on, one out here in the Miami half of the fifth inning. Just missed with an off-speed pitch, 2-1.
See, the other thing that's happening now is we get a good look at Angie Ramos. Ramos, the pitcher's wife. But now he's changing his whole philosophy, worrying about that runner on first instead of going after the hitter.
Seaver has stolen 18 bases, but you wonder if he is going to be going in this situation. Of course, Miami, that's what Miami does. They run. Off-speed pitch just missed, 3-1.
Remember when he was getting the ball and just working? Now he's starting to think a little bit, and that's what happens. A little bang and a base hit and you're back in it.
Lost him. Two walks and two hits in the inning.
Don't even need to say anything about that picture right there.
Go, Mark, come on now.
Are the wheels coming off for Ramos here in the fifth? Esquivel, 0 for 2. Ramos has now walked five in this game to go with the three hits. Off speed, missed badly again.
When I played for Jim Lefevre in Seattle, he always said, play for the fifth inning. It's the toughest inning for any pitcher because that's when they go on record. And regardless of what the score might be, pitchers always struggle in the fifth inning.
Top foul, twisting back into the right field stand. Yeah, that's an excellent point.
They got to get through the fifth to get the W. It seems like they tighten up and they struggle through that fifth. Ever since he told me that, I see that all the time.
Esquivel with that 0 for 2 has seen his average drop to 347.
Got him.
1-1 pickoff. They got him. Here's the throw to third. He's out. Second man picked off in this ball game.
Well, Seaver tipped it off. Now, this is a great situation to run right here. But Seaver tipped it off because he started getting too loud. What I mean by that is he started jumping around. You see him jumping there? He brought attention to himself. And the second baseman just put a little daylight play on, and they got him.
Picked off 1-4-5.
And that pickoff happened, actually, Mike, the pitch before. Because the pitch before, he started to go, and all of a sudden he drew attention to himself. And they didn't go. Now you alert all the infielders that, hey, there might be a pick, might be a steal here. And that was a time pickoff play.
Now you have Crespo at second with two gone. And the count 1-2 to Esquivel. Hit hard, diving stop at third by Fox. Throws too high. That'll score a run. And Esquivel will get into second base. Fox made the first half of the play brilliantly and then came up and threw too high for Baker at first.
Wow. Well, we talked about Miami just hanging in there, hanging in there, hanging in there. And they've done it again. Now watch Fox, like you said, Mike, he did a tremendous job. Great dive, he even got to his feet and set and made a nice strong throw, but released it a little high, and Baker just wasn't able to climb the ladder and get that one.
They're gonna give him an error all the way that allows the run to score and lets Esquivel make it into second base with the tying run, and Kevin Brown is up.
Now, Seaver doesn't get picked right there. They're running on that ball being hit.
Four-three, Miami has clawed its way back within a run. And Ramos, with that 13-2 record, has seen his four-run cushion evaporate.
And this is the tough call for the coach down there, because you want to see him try to get a W, but you don't want the game to slip away. This is the inning of record.
Ramos with the 2-0 count on Brown. Missed again. 3-0 to the power hitter.
I'm surprised that the catcher or somebody hasn't gone out, had a little conversation, settled things down.
Brown with 20 home runs this season, and he lost them on four straight.
So he's clearly needs a little break.
That's the third walk of the inning.
Just break things up a little bit, go out, settle him down. This is the guy you want to get. You got the left-handed hitter coming up here.
Rodriguez, who was hit by a pitch and then fly to right, stands in with two out and two on.
This guy loves baseball tonight. I got to throw that in there. He loves it. He came up to me raving about the show.
There are Harold Reynolds fans everywhere. Freshman All-American with a great future. Turned down a bonus from the Tampa Bay club to come to Miami. Was one of these guys that they did get enrolled after the draft.
Right. You know, some guys are better off going to college. You're going to grow up. You're going to develop. And sometimes it's tough to turn down a couple million dollars, too.
I would find it extremely difficult. Huh? 2-1. Thirtieth pitch of the inning for Ramos, who has really struggled here. And time called by the home plate umpire, Dan Peterson. Rodriguez, the eighth man to bat in the inning. Ramos trying to get out of this jam with the lead intact. The 2-1 foul back out of play. A real defensive swing that time by Rodriguez, 2-2.
Yeah, fighting that ball off. But I was impressed his last at-bat, Mike, where he flew out to right field on a breaking pitch. But it just showed me signs of even after he got hit, he was still going to hang in there and battle you. So you know he is not one of the type of left-handed hitters who's going to bail out. Ramos is going to have to earn getting this out if he gets him out.
The Owls fans on their feet. Hit toward left. That one's going to drop for a base hit. Here comes the throw from Williams. Offline, and we're tied at four. Both runners advance. What a comeback by the Canes.
Wow. And here comes Coach Graham. They just played the way they're supposed to play, the way the Canes like to play the game. They just scrapped and fought. They got a break on the home run, and they're back in it.
And Rodriguez hung in there, lefty against lefty, punched it into left field for the base hit and the RBI that ties it.
Well, and you knew he would. I mean, he battled the pitch before when he flew out, and right there, stayed with that ball and flipped it into left field.
And Ramos will be done in 4 2/3. And Jeff Nichols will be the new pitcher for the Rice Owls. We'll check on him when we come back. Tied at four in the fifth.
As a force player, the only way you get better is to play against defenders that are bigger, stronger, and meaner than you. There you go. Come on. You have to take the paint. Nobody owns the paint.
And don't bring your C game to count four. Bring your A game.
Man, you're going to get rejected by someone who didn't have 10. Come show him how it's done.
Let's go,
Tractor.
Show him how it's done now.
Uh-oh. Richie, we got a triple scoop here.
Oh, hi there. Michael Landrum for Timex, here with the Timex Turn and Pull Alarm Watch. Just turn the ring either way and pull the crown to set it for short or long-term reminders. Let's try setting it for 11 minutes. Just turn the ring and pull the crown. Tune in next week when we discuss walking. The Timex Turn and Pull Alarm Watch. So simple, we should have thought of it years ago.
He's pressed for time, but he's still gonna get a great shine. Introducing new Turtle Wax Express Shine Liquid Car Wax. Just wipe on, there's no buffing. The rich Carnauba formula gives you hard shell protection and breakthrough shine in no time. No, no! Great for all finishes, clear coats too. Turtle Wax Express Shine, spray or new liquid. And for vinyl and rubber, get Formula 2001, the super protectant.
Ramos is done after 4 2/3 as Miami has come from behind to tie it up. He threw 104 pitches, still responsible for the two runners on base. The last two runs scored in this inning are unearned. And Jeff Nichols will be the new pitcher. 22 games, 15-3 on the season. Leads the staff, has a good curveball and a changeup, fastball 85 to 90 miles an hour. Sometimes he has struggled with his command, has gotten behind a lot of guys, but hasn't issued all that many walks.
And this is where he really needs to get ahead of a hitter, need to get out of this jam right here.
Lovelady, the ninth man to hit in the inning. First pitch is low and has to be blocked by Zane Curry. Lovelady 0 for 2. Fly to center and a grounder to third. The lead runs on with two out. Again in the dirt, blocked by Curry.
Well, Curry's showing me something. Because runner on third base, a lot of times the catcher will be afraid to call a breaking ball because he doesn't want to bounce it in the dirt past him, and it's a 5-4 ball game. But he shows the confidence. I can block anything you throw up here. I can catch it.
He's calling the pitches he wants. Again, low, 3-0. So Nichols comes out of the bullpen, an unfamiliar role for him, and falls behind 3-0 to Lovelady. Fastball is in there.
See, he's really giving Lovelady the advantage, though. He threw two breaking balls the first two pitches they've seen. Then he throws him a fastball, and he's able to be ahead in the count. And now he's on, sitting in a 3-1 situation where he's seen his best two pitches.
Strike call, 3-2. Wow. Rice trying to get out of this inning. Two-run homer was the big blow. Here's the 3-2.
Oh, man.
Struck him out. Nice job by Nichols, who got in the 3-0 hole and came back to strike out Lovelady to end the inning. But Miami has made a game of it. They put four on the board to tie it up.
Oh. Mm. Oh. Oh, baby.
Hey, Mr. Dinky's busy.
Nah. Hey, Dinky, I quit.
Oh, no.
Mr. Dinky, I'm not quitting. That was a joke, sir.
Hello? Yeah. I got your report. Thanks very much. Mr. Platton?
Hey! He's on vacation.
Want to win an extreme vacation?
Call 1-800-C-A-L-L-A-T-T.
Dial 1-800-CALL-ATT for collect calls now, and you can win an extreme vacation like surfing or heliskiing and win tons of other cool prizes instantly. Call now. The more times you call, the more chances you have to win.
Two words, hot stock, perfect for us.
You get a sexy portfolio that'll make you rich. Me, a small commission.
Trust me, I'm only here to make you money.
Before you go here, go here. Whether you're tracking your own stocks or the market, at go.com, you're in charge.
Perfect night for baseball. The weatherman has cooperated in spite of threats of showers and thundershowers. And we go to the top of the sixth at Rosenblatt with Rice in Miami locked up in a 4-4 duel. Ramos is finished. He will not be the pitcher of record. Lost a 4-run lead in the fifth. And Gill is still on the mound for the Miami Hurricanes.
Both a surprise. You wouldn't think Ramos would have been out of the game the way he'd been on a roll. They nicked and banged him, finally got to him. And Gill, I thought, would have been out of here by now. He's got the game tied back up. He's got 115 pitches.
Matt Fox, the number nine man, leading it off here for Rice in the sixth.
I just tell him, thank you. You got us back in the game.
Yeah.
Let's take our chances.
We'll see you on Sunday or Monday.
Absolutely.
Missed again. Fox will be doing anything he can now to get on with a 3-0 count. Wants to lead off the inning so they can get back to the top of the order. This is a team that's averaged 8 runs a game throughout the course of the season, this Rice ball club.
Now, I can see how, too. You know, they got a little bit of pop, but they put the ball in play. They make a lot of contact, and when you're able to do that, you're going to score a lot of runs.
And they have arguably the best pitching staff in college baseball, and from what we've seen today, an excellent defense behind it. Strike two called.
Sometimes when you, this situation right here, I don't know if I'd have gave him a take on 3-1 because you lose your aggressiveness. You battle back. You got to go ahead and change the momentum of the game.
Lost him on a low fastball. So Fox leads off the inning with a base on balls here in the sixth. Later this month, the best extreme athletes in the world invade San Francisco for the fifth annual Summer X Games. Events include sky surfing, street luge, skateboarding, and downhill inline racing. You can check out all the action on ESPN, ESPN2, and ABC Sports from June 27th till July 5th. For more, log on to ESPN.com, part of the Go Network, go.com. Tell you what, I don't want part of anything that says sky surfing. I don't know about you.
I was just thinking, Mike, I could see you sky surfing right now.
Yeah, straight down. Williams has walked twice and struck out his first trip. Bird now facing the top of the order. Or David Gill, check it. And time called by the home plate umpire. Late on a fastball. It's another record crowd here tonight, Harold. A session record of 23,267 for an opening night. Terrific, but the seventh best attendance ever at the College World Series. 23,267. Strike three called on a pitch that looked like it was 9 inches off the plate on the outside. And Williams just turns and wheels and walks back to the dugout.
They tried to keep the ball away from him all night. Now, Mike, you're not kidding. The catcher's in the other batter's box. And
he is set up outside so far. Now, watch where this pitch is. Whoa.
Goodness.
Well, that's got to be discouraging. I mean, you couldn't hit that with an oar. And it's called strike three.
Oh, my goodness.
Brett Smith standing, and there you see the frustration on the face of Charles Williams.
This is not the big leagues. You're not going to see these kids get in the umpire's face.
Right.
You know, your coach is the only one who's going to be able to argue anything, and you just got to grit it and take it.
He can bite holes in that lower lip, though. Brett Smith walked and two singles to show for his effort against David Gill tonight. Strike called, 2-1. Damon Thames is on deck. The go-to guy for this Rice ball club. Hitting the air to right center. Crespo camps under it. Two gone.
Remember early in the game, I was talking about the momentum that Rice had. You could just feel it.
Sure.
Well, it swung the other way.
Yeah, old Mo has definitely gone to green and orange.
Yes, it has. And that's the interesting thing about college athletics. You know, they play on such an emotional high that you can feel everything. Baseball is supposed to be the laid back. You don't feel the emotion. But you can feel it here.
It's interesting that we're talking about Thames earlier. He had the 26 home runs last year, only 9 this year. And Wayne Graham said virtually every hanging curve he got last year, he hit about 440 feet. This year he fouls them off. Sometimes it just goes that way.
Yeah, it does.
He'd love to get one right here. Inside fastball, 1-1.
Kid's got a bright future, though. You can tell he's a gifted ball player.
First team all everything. Up and in, 2-1.
Gill's starting to get a little bit tired. He's not able to put that ball inside like he was earlier with consistency and strike. A lot of that starts to happen. Your arm starts to drag through the zone, and particularly with the right-hand hitter, the ball starts to drift into him.
Two men out, a runner at first in a tie ball game, sixth inning for Rice. Thames hits it to dead center field. Seaver has a beat on it, and the inning is over. So Gill gets out of another inning and has gone through six in a tie game, 4-4.
I've been proclaiming the truth of the Bible for many years, and it never fails. Every time I open God's Word, I discover something new and thrilling. When you visit the Second Baptist family, that's exactly what you will experience. Something fresh and forever life-changing. Come and see. God's way really works.
Come and see. Saturdays at Second Baptist Church.
As a 15-year NBA veteran, I know how difficult success is to achieve. But imagine 45 years. That's how long Demontron has been around.
Demontron has been serving Houston for over 45 years, and we've seen a lot of changes to the products we represent, like the new Oldsmobiles. They're aggressive, sporty, sleek, stylish, and affordable. So if you haven't driven an Oldsmobile lately, come test drive the new 99s at Demontron. Right people, the right prices, the right choice. You won't find a better deal.
Great moments in college sports make great memories and often inspire great achievement beyond the game. Come see it all at the Hall, the new NCAA Hall of Champions, a place to relive the action, savor the memories, discover what it means to be a true champion, and that might be the greatest moment sports has ever produced. The NCAA Hall of Champions, opening in downtown Indianapolis in March 2000.
4-4 in the bottom of the sixth. Ramos no longer the pitcher of record. And let's take a look, Harold, what happened to him in that disastrous inning.
Well, Bobby Hill hits a ball that everybody thought was out of the ballpark until we saw the replay, and it was obviously not out of the park. Then the great play by Fox, he makes the high throw, overthrow, scored another run, and then Rodriguez fights off one, drips it into left field. So a home run that wasn't a homer, an error, and a blooper. And the next thing you know, you find yourself on the bench.
104 pitches for Ramos, well behind what Gill has thrown, however. In Miami, a team that sent nine men up in the last inning, will now get Marcus Nettles in as a pinch hitter for Walker. Nettles, 356, very little power. Fans at one, got a piece, it's 2-1. So Walker is finished as the DH as Nichols, the right-hander, comes in. Missed, 3-1. And he lost him. Let's check in with Dave Ryan. Dave, what do you have?
Well, Mike, a group of over-exuberant young fans were responsible for interfering with play on the Bobby Hill homer for Miami in the bottom of the fifth inning. It turns out four teenage boys were escorted out of the ballpark by a county deputy. Same rules, guys, apply in this stadium as they do in the major leagues. If you lean over, interfere with play, you're out. If you fall onto the field, that's trespassing, and you get arrested. So thankfully for those youngsters, they were just escorted out of the ballpark and can't come back tonight.
Yeah, but those rules, Dave, don't apply in New York. You become a hero.
Absolutely.
If you're Jeffrey Mayer, you do.
That's right. Well, that's a shame, and certainly that's not going to be any comfort to Ramos.
No, it's a little late now.
And we're back to Chris Klute with Bobby Hill on deck, and everybody expecting sacrifice bunt.
Oh, he got it.
And they had him picked at first and got him. The third pickoff of the game. Marcus Nettles draws a walk, and then trying to get the good lead with the bunt coming is picked off of first.
We got him leaning right here. Now, see him leaning. It might have been a little bunt and run or something, and they slapped the tag back. But you see the lean. Now, the toughest thing to do is change their momentum and get back. That's
That's a huge play. It's enormous.
Huge play. Because we are right back into Miami's hands playing their type of ball game. They want to bunt, move runners over.
So now Clute, the number nine man, is in an 0-2 hole against Nichols.
Wow.
And Nichols just missed with that one.
Got to go off the plate. Get that call.
The 1-2 is hit hard to left. Williams going back, and that one is gone. So after they thought they had him struck out, Clute rips one over the left field wall, and Miami has taken the lead 5-4.
I can hear Jim Morris right now saying, that is just great coaching.
Yes, sir.
Joking around, he'd say, Harold, that's great coaching.
Only his
third home run
of the year.
I can't believe this. Look at his face. He's sitting there going, I don't understand this. You put your bunter into a hole with 0-2 because he's trying to move the runner over. The guy gets picked off, and then he gets a fastball down the middle and drives it out of the ballpark. Only his second all year?
Third.
Third all year.
He was talking... The coaching staff, Jim Morris, talking this morning about having a player with a 3-0 count, and naturally, what are you going to do? You're going to have him take a pitch. He says, no, I had him swing away, and he hit a home run. That's why we were talking about Miami pushing all the right buttons, and Bobby Hill smokes one back through the box for a base hit.
Bobby Hill's negotiating his contract right now is what he's doing.
Last time up, he had that controversial two-run homer.
Comes up from the left side this time. He gets a fastball and drives it back up the middle. He's having a great night. And now he's got a right-handed pitcher, so you got to turn him loose again. He doesn't have to worry about the pickoff from Ramos. We'll see what happens with Hill at first.
Seaver is up, and he's gone on the first pitch. And they got him. Oh, they dropped the ball. What a throw by Zane Curry. But they couldn't hold the throw. Curry put it right on top of the bag.
The ball gets there right when the slide. Bobby Hill with a late, hard slide. And sometimes, Mike, that's the advantage of sliding feet first as opposed to sliding head first. You slide head first, you don't knock this ball out of his hands. You go feet first, not able to catch on to it. With the collision with the ball getting at the same time.
That's an error on the second baseman, Brett Smith.
He gets a great jump on a slide step. You can see it's a straight steal because he doesn't peak. But because he slides hard and late, he was able to knock the ball out and catch your reaction.
Curry is just disconsolate. I mean, you couldn't ask for a better throw against a guy who was Miami's career stolen base leader. As you said, got the good jump. And Curry put it right there.
And he'll take off and go to third right here, too. They better keep him close. He was looking to do it.
In the dirt, Curry blocks it again.
The one thing you teach base runners is you steal second, the very next pitch, go to third. Because nobody has a time to regroup, particularly the catcher. He's still thinking about the fact they dropped the ball on him. He's not worried about you going to third. So just keep the pressure right on. Go to the very next pitch.
One out here in the Miami sixth. Now a runner at second. Hill with great speed. And Seaver takes a pitch high 2-1.
Hill's going right here.
Did you find it easier to steal third?
Yeah, because pitchers would have a tendency not to pay attention to you. They start thinking about that hitter and that possible RBI.
And in, and it got away from Curry. Hill will advance to third. And it's starting to come apart for the Rice Owls.
It really is. And here's a good move by Coach Graham right here. Just come out and talk and settle things down. Fastball just got away. You know, we see that a lot here at the College World Series. I'm wondering if there's a dead spot out there because I see that catchers lose that ball up and in constantly here in this ballpark.
Yeah, and it didn't look like he was crossed up on that one either.
No, it really didn't.
Wayne Graham trying to settle down his relief pitcher, Jeff Nichols. who now finds himself in a first and third jam with one out and Crespo coming to the plate. And his club now down by a run.
Notice the middle infielders didn't even go to the mound. Sometimes when you make the mistake, you don't want to go talk to
yeah,
coach.
That's right.
I'll stay all the way out here. You go ahead and talk to everybody else.
Brett Smith didn't want to come in.
He wasn't coming in there. I've been there. I understand, Brett. No problem. But now you want the ball hit to you. This is a situation you want to come right back. Get us a double play. Let's get out of here and help yourself out.
Mark Gwynn and Kurtz Nickel, who is the closer. They have no problem with bringing him in the seventh inning, maybe even a little earlier as a closer.
You got the third to first move two times now. With Hill on third base and Seaver at first, he may not try to straight steal all the way. He might stop, pull that old Billy Martin stop midway and make him make a play on you, and Hill comes on home. You want to try to steal a run here some way. And Miami, with the reputation of Morris talking about we like to be aggressive, they might try to do something, Mike.
They've had two runners picked off in the last two innings when they have scored all their runs. They could be way up now, except for those plays.
Put an anchor on.
Absolutely. Use the old softball rule. You have to stay on a bag till the ball crosses the plate. First four innings, only one hit, and they have come alive in the fifth and the sixth. 2-1 to Manny Crespo. Runners at first and third, one gone. Infield to double play depth. The outfield around to the left. Crespo chops it foul. 2-2. You were talking about momentum early when Rice had it and how it had shifted to Miami. It looks like it is clearly with Miami. And frankly, they have gotten every break as well.
Oh, they really have. They've got the home run, the outside calls on pitches.
And the pitch before this last home run that Rice thought they had a called strike three, which would have gotten them out of that.
Absolutely. Very good.
Runner goes, they're not going to make a throw, and it's ball four anyway. So they're loaded for Esquivel, the cleanup man. The Rice pitchers, Ramos and Nichols, have had nine walks, a hit batsman, and a wild pitch in this game.
And if you'd have told them they were going to do that before the game, they would have thought you were crazy. This is one of the nation's top pitching staffs.
Sometimes that's what pressure does to you. And when you're here for the College World Series, this is as pressurized situation as you can get. Esquivel reached on an error his last time up. He's 0 for 3. Smoke and stand again by Fox. Steps on third, throws to first. Double
mercy.
That's what happens when you stay aggressive.
That is a two-run double. And Matt Fox atoning for an earlier error with a brilliant stab. The presence of mind to get the out at third and throw across to complete the double play. Nice pick by Baker at first.
Scent of exhilaration from Aquavelva, now available in new skin conditioning gel.
What a shot. How'd you do it?
With the Elf. There's nothing to it. The Elf 370Z is full of surprises, like a three-time zoom and three picture sizes. Have you seen all the Elves?
What a shot. From Canon.
You're sweating like crazy.
You got TV cameras all over you.
The last thing you want is this white, clumpy thing running down your arm.
It's just rude.
We asked some of the hottest pros under the sun to switch antiperspirants.
Green invisible solid? What's that?
I would assume it goes on clear, but I'm not sure I believe that.
When your body heats up, the green invisible solid releases extra protection with a clear difference.
Right there. See, there's no white stuff. The harder I work, the harder it works.
No flaking, no funk, no Klingons.
Degree Invisible Solid. Works hard but never shows.
After the match, there's a ton of girls. Gotta be cool.
Ed Kerpius runs a bread store in Wayne, Pennsylvania.
Love being the bread man. It's like being the mayor.
You want cinnamon swirl?
Great Harvest Bread links owners like Ed together using Microsoft software.
We just share tons of information. You know, how do you merchandise? What are the bagel guys doing? Why is that store out in Michigan jamming?
What do you want?
Ed's dream was to have a business in his hometown.
Who wouldn't want to be the bread man? Wouldn't you want to walk around and be the bread man? Everyone walks around and says, hey, that's the bread man.
Matt Fox, who made that inning-ending double play. Harold, we talked about momentum. A defensive play like that can get old Mo back on your side.
Oh, well, you called it best. This was a two-run double, but look at the layout. We were talking about this in between. That is a better play in replay. Now, that's an aluminum bat. Now, you wonder if he touched the base. He hits it with his left foot. The follow-through makes the perfect throw. Great play.
I hope Brooks Robinson's watching this game and says, yeah, that looks familiar.
Yes, indeed. Because everybody, you know, you don't go down to third base unless you want to make a Brooks Robinson play. I mean, that's every
right.
kid's dream. Oh, here goes Brooks or Greg Nettles. So Greg Nettles said, hey, I want to be like Brooks. So everybody, it starts with Brooks.
He will be a shortstop next year. He had struggled early at third base. They said now he's become reliable. Well, I tell you, he just took the next step. He's gone way beyond reliable.
He might have lost his shortstop job right
there. Vince Vasquez will come on to pitch here in the seventh inning. And he'll start it off against Will Ford, the cleanup man. Ford doubled his first time up, struck out the last time. Looks like the strike zone has shrunk as the game has gone on.
Yeah, it's been everywhere.
That one's outside, 2-1. Vasquez out of Miramar, Florida, freshman, 6'2", 213.
Is that all the...
High, ball three. Ford, Gray, and Berg scheduled to hit for Rice. They were coasting with a 4-0 lead, but Miami has come back to make it a 5-4 game. Canes off the fists. Bobby Hill takes it on the short hop and throws him out. Let's go to Dave Ryan. Dave, what do you have?
Well, Mike, you see on the side of Vince Vasquez's hat as he's out in the relief for the Miami Hurricanes now. He's got a couple of numbers written on the side there in pen, and they're for pitchers who have gone down this year with injuries for the Hurricanes. Number 34, Chris Sheffield. Number 18, Ryan Channel. Number 36, Greg Howell. All blew out their elbows and needed Tommy John reconstructive elbow surgery. They're all expected guys to play a big role with the Hurricanes. It's part of the walking wounded Miami team this year, and they've really not forgotten their fallen teammates. It's kind of brought them together quite a bit as well.
That's really nice, Dave. And there's another guy, you know, you could add to that list, Spasoff, who was hurt after the College World Series last year and had to have shoulder surgery and really hasn't had very many innings since then.
That's one reader board you don't want to make.
No.
Wow.
Jason Gray stands in. Took a big cut and missed it. Gray 1-for-2 with a walk tonight. In the dirt, they'll have to throw him out, and do. Two gone quickly here in the Rice seventh inning.
Well, I got a feeling we need to fasten our seatbelts because we're going to be in for a photo finish.
Well, that's exactly what we expected from these two ball clubs. Despite the disparity in the 1-8 seeds, they are very, very close. Have been all year in the national rankings.
So the one advantage that Miami does have is they played such a great schedule, Mike, and they played tight games that they've had to come back and win. So they're used to this type of a battle.
Plus
not that Rice hasn't had been tough games. But
exactly. But Miami has also been here so many times, coaching staff and players alike. Justin Berg with two out and nobody on.
And the one stat that just stands out in my mind is they beat Florida State 5 times this year.
You can bet it stands out in Florida State's mind, too. It's something when you're in-state rivalry. may be the two best teams in the country.
Yeah.
And then you throw Florida in there, which has had a tremendous upcoming program under Andy Garcia. They had a down year this year. But you play in-state, you're playing some good people.
Florida Atlantic had one of the top ERAs in the country. So
Jacksonville had a pretty good club this year.
Yeah, just in the state. They don't have to go anywhere to play good competition. But I guess you could say that about the Pac-10, too. Right?
Wave! Russell, taking a picture.
Whoa, foul tipped. 2-2. Well, if you're a baseball player, you got to play in the South, and you just don't get that many games in.
No, you're right.
I mean, Mankato State hasn't made it here too many times. Strike three call. Three up, three down here in the Rice seventh inning. We'll go to the Miami seventh in a moment. Stay with us.
Wherever your kids want to go this summer, there's a Red Roof Inn nearby.
Beaches, theme parks at a price that'll make everybody happy, especially you.
Well, I'm lost. Anybody got a map?
Call 1-800-THE-ROOF, where kids stay free and save money like you mean it.
This is the sale of the century. Nobody works the numbers like me. Honest, Bob. Tax, license, wheels not included. Heck, nothing's included. Come on down and spend your hard-earned cash today.
Before you go here, go here. Whether you're comparing prices or options, at Go.com, you're in the driver's seat.
Yeah, hook me up quick. Got a date. I better call.
Got change.
Change?
Brother, here's a shortcut. Dial 1-800-CALL-ATT and call baby girl collect.
Whoops.
See, when you call collect and dial 1-800-CALL-ATT, you pay one low rate all the time. Guaranteed cheap.
I'm stylish.
Oh, you look fly. Woo! That's called the half row. Dial 1-800-CALL-ATT, the guaranteed cheap way to call collect. Next!
Bottom of the seventh at Rosenblatt Stadium in Omaha, the College World Series, Miami, leading at 5-4 over the Owls of Rice. And Miami will come up here in the seventh with a 4-5-6 hitters in the order, trying to add to that margin. And when they're ahead, you can expect anything.
Yeah, the game's back into Miami's hands because they like to be the type of team that's going to run, hit and run, put pressure on you. But you know what? They broke out the long ball tonight, Mike.
That's right.
They weren't supposed to.
Esquivel to lead it off against Nichols. Chop foul outside third. Esquivel, Brown, and Rodriguez, the scheduled hitter. Esquivel was the MVP. Or check it, Brown, the first hitter up, as Esquivel made the last out of the previous inning. Excuse me.
And what a last out that was, the play Fox made.
Strike call 1-2.
Brown, Rodriguez, and Loveday, they've had the best at-bats of the whole Miami team. Well, Bobby Hill's had a great night, but
yes, yeah.
Really, it's the bottom of the order is what's carried these guys.
Oh, smoked to third, blocked by Fox. Knocks it down, throws high again. This one's off the tarp. So Fox again makes a good defensive play, but his second throwing error of the night.
This is just a rocket off his chest. Did a great job of squaring his body up. Watch how square he gets so that when the ball bounces off of him, it's going to go in front of him. So that's, you see him even slide his feet to the right to keep it in front of him, but he just came up and tried to hurry a throw. And anytime you hurry, that's usually where the delivery is going to be, is high. Great job of catching it bare hand. He knew as soon as he left it, he's jumping trying to get up to catch it.
And on both of those throws, he's had time to get the runner.
Yes, he has. had quick reactions to go get the ball.
Another two base throwing error. And Rodriguez, his job will be to get that man over to third, either by pulling it to the right side or bunting.
They're going to give him one pitch right there like they did to pull the ball. You can see his approach. It was a fastball away. He still tried to hook it. Now, I would think that they'd probably put the bunt on.
That'll bring Fox in from third. I mean, doesn't show bunt there.
Not being cruel, Mike, but I'm bunting the ball at Fox right now. I'm going to make him have to field it.
Yep.
And throw the ball again.
Well, you'd like him to field it in this situation anyway to get the runner over.
Absolutely.
Foul back. So they don't go with the bunt. Jim Morris trying to cross him up again in a 1-2 situation. As I've seen Miami teams of the past bunt with two strikes. Rodriguez taps it to the right side. Pitcher has to cover. Nichols gets there, but he gets the runner over to third.
See, that situation right there, you don't throw the guy a breaking ball so he can top it and hook it. Throw him a fastball, make him hit the ball to the left side of the infield where the runner cannot advance if he's going to hit it at all.
Tanya Graham, wife of the Rice head coach Wayne Graham, and she too, a Rice graduate. She had gone to junior college into Houston when Wayne got the job at Rice. She goes back to school and got a degree in exercise science, so she must be an extremely bright lady. Chop toward third. Fox comes home. Too high. Another throwing error on Fox. Down to second. Not in time. So Fox just having a terrible time after making the plays at third. That one, a desperation throw to Curry, too high at the plate.
Well, you're right. Desperation is the proper word because he tried to rush his throw right here. When the ball, the grass is really thick here at Rosenblatt. Now, when it hits the grass, the runner's going on contact. He's coming right now with the high chop. He really doesn't have a play. He tried to rush his throw, and even if he'd have got the ball down, I think the runner might have been safe. But when you have a tendency to rush it and try to throw the ball too hard, again, he ends up with a high throw.
It is a fielder's choice. He gets an RBI, the official score, I think rightfully ruling he would have scored regardless of the throw. But another throwing error charged to Fox as Lovelady gets down to second base. And Rice will go to the bullpen once more. Now trailing 6-4. And Kurtz Nickel will come on. We'll check on his numbers when we come back. And Rice miscues have led to a two-run Miami lead.
Fingers celebrates 72 years of helping furnish over half the homes in Houston with more selection for the way you live today. More savings, more ways to help you feel right at home.
Put away your checkbook. You don't pay a cent till January 2000.
If it's been a while since you shopped Fingers, this should bring you back.
Register to win this Ford Expedition from Lawrence Marshall.
So, what are you waiting for? The 72nd anniversary sale is at your fingers.
Our bodies need good food. That's why every day we should have at least one what?
Classic shake combo.
Yes, a classic shake combo with a frosty shake made with real ice cream. And where do we go for milkshakes made with real ice cream?
McDonald's.
Question?
My mommy says ice cream milkshakes make you fat.
Tell your mommy to be happy with who she is and stop being bitter about her thighs.
Okay.
Game one, a thriller. Game two, even the score. Now it's a battle in Buffalo. Stanley Cup Finals, Stars, Sabres, Game 3. Tomorrow at 8, only on ESPN.
Miami with a 6-4 lead here in the bottom of the seventh. This is the second game of the opening round of the College World Series. Earlier today, Alabama starter Justin Smith got in a jam right off the bat, but he got out of it, striking out Oklahoma State slugger Lamont Matthews with the bases loaded. Then he froze the nation's RBI leader twice more in the game. Bama's bats exploded for three home runs and an 11-run, 15-hit barrage that carried the Crimson Tide and Justin Smith to victory this afternoon and advances them in the winner's bracket. They will meet the winner of tonight's game, and right now Miami has a leg up on that one with a 6-4 lead. There are the brackets with Oklahoma State and Alabama. Alabama advancing, Oklahoma State falling into the loser's bracket. They will meet the loser of tonight's game. And in the other brackets, we'll see for the first time Florida State, Texas A&M. That's a 1:30 start on CBS. Our night game on the Deuce tomorrow night, Stanford and Cal State Fullerton. Jamie Kurtz-Nickel, the new pitcher, comes in and gives up a long fly ball deep right. Ford goes all the way to the wall to make the catch. So we have seen some spectacular defense by Rice, but three throwing errors have gotten them in a lot of trouble.
Well, you're right, Mike. This ball was drove to the right side. Rodriguez a little ticked off, thought he had it, but man, a great job of staying with this ball the whole way. Ford crashing the wall and getting it back into the infield fast. That was the key to this play. He got the ball back into the infield because they were thinking about sending him all the way from second base, but he got the ball back in. The runner held at third.
Jesse Kurtz-Nickel is the new pitcher for the Owls of Rice. He comes in here with one out in the seventh. And Kurtz-Nickel with a 7-1 record to go with eight saves. Been outstanding this year.
99 strikeouts.
Senior from Los Angeles. Off-speed pitch down in the dirt blocked by Curry. Chris Klute, the number nine man in the order with two out and a runner at third. Miami now up by two. Right back up the box, base hit. And Klute, who has had some big hits this year, delivers with an RBI single.
Well, Miami has just kept chipping away all night. They were down four in the beginning of the game, and they continued to just keep the pressure on right there, going right back up the middle. Pitcher wasn't able to catch that ball. It came off the bat pretty quick.
Ouch. Kurtz-Nickel got the heel of his glove on it, but that's all. And Wayne Graham now finds his club down by three. Miami has benefited from nine walks, a hit batsman, and four errors tonight. Back to the top of the order for Bobby Hill. And they just can't get him out.
Yeah, I was going to say, he's had a rough night, huh?
Singled his first time up, then walked, then a two-run homer, and another single. Has the average up to 387.
And he's got it done from both sides of the plate. Got the one base hit from the left side of the plate, and then the home run and the other hit from the right side, and back over on the right side of the plate again.
Kurtz-Nickel with another low toss, and Curry down on his knees to block it. 2-0, two out, one on. And with Miami's pitching and defense, Rice can ill afford to give them any more here in the seventh inning. They only have six outs to go offensively. Fastball missed high. It's 3-0. Hill taking all the way. It's 3-1.
I was thinking if he got a free pass, Mike, it's kind of reminiscent of a couple days ago. He got to fly in first class.
That's right. They bumped several of the players up because I guess they combined a couple of flights and it was oversold. Cox. Matt Fox throws him out after a tough inning for him with three throwing errors for the ballgame. Fox gets the last out, but it's 7-4 Miami.
There was never anyone like him. Michael Jordan soared above them all. All the excitement of Jordan's fabulous career is captured in this exclusive collection from Sports Illustrated, the new Michael Jordan Thrill Pack, free with your paid subscription to SI. You'll get this great Michael Jordan hardbound commemorative. It takes you along with the magnificent Michael from college to the pros on a thrilling championship flight that gives you a close-up look at the life and career of the one and only Michael Jordan. You'll also get Michael Jordan, a career in pictures, a dazzling display of those unforgettable Jordan moments. Enjoy a free thrill pack with your order of 54 issues of SI for only $1.47 an issue. Save over 50% off the cover price. You'll also get this great Sports Illustrated sports watch free when you use your credit card. Call now to get your exclusive Michael Jordan thrill pack plus the SI sports watch, all free from SI. He is the best there has ever been. Keep the thrills coming. Call now.
Hey!
What are you doing up here?
So, you've been using 10-10-3-2-1?
What? Oh, I keep forgetting about that.
Well, you should try to remember. You get 50% off calls over 10 minutes, every day, anytime.
Huh. Well, I like that. But there's got to be a monthly fee, right?
Not with 10-10-3-2-1. Dial it, and you'll see the savings on your phone bill.
All right. I'll give it a try.
Cool. Hey! Get away from my car!
Just dial 10-10-3-2-1.
They've got the Owl with them, but they're down by three. And for Rice third baseman Matt Fox, it has been really an up-and-down ball game.
Yeah, baseball can be like that sometimes. You know, it's the craziest game. You can go 3-for-10, and you've been successful. That means you failed seven times.
But you can't make three throwing errors.
No, you can't. But he had an unbelievable play right here. He dives and makes the high throw. Cause a run, and then he came up with this spectacular play. That's keeping the game close, saving two runs from coming in. A bullet off the chest, and he tries to rush and make another strong throw. You can see he's got the strong arm, and he's going to be a fine player. But sometimes you're going to make mistakes, and right here he rushes. The best thing that could have happened to him to end the inning was he got that ground ball, made a nice throw across the diamond. You got to stay strong and just expect things to be hit to you, and
that's
you're going
right.
to make errors sometimes.
Jacob Baker will lead it off in the Rice eighth inning. He is 2-for-3, and in the last couple of weeks, he's gotten his batting average up 20 points. The coaches are saying, for some reason, he has more bat speed and has become a better hitter with two strikes. And they need some of his magic right now as he fouls one back out of play and throws him two. Bottom of the order, Baker, Curry, and Fox to hit here in the Rice eighth.
Vasquez is getting the ball and working quick again. It's funny how you watch the game, the momentum swings has a lot to do with how the pitchers are on the mound. They get the ball and go, seem to be the momentum would go their way.
Foul back out of play off the right side.
A big swing right there. He must have saw that ball pretty good. The big hat.
Baker not much of a power hitter, 5 home runs. Right now, they just need base runners here in the eighth.
Well, he's got that open stance, Mike, and Miami's been trying to exploit that open stance all night. They've been keeping everything away. We talked about this earlier today, how far he has to go to reach that ball on the outside half.
And there's a perfect example. Had to go down and away to try to get that one and couldn't do it. One gone.
Seen a lot of open stances in college baseball today. Now look how far he has to go to reach this slider. He's just got no chance. If you're going to stay open, you got to bring that front foot back and close it. He brings it, drops it right back in the same spot, so he never closes that gap, and therefore you're not able to reach that outside pitch.
Vasquez has struck out the last three batters he has faced. Fastball high to Zane Curry. Had his best hacks the first time up when he lined one to right center field. Breaking ball in there for a call strike. Matt Fox bats on deck. If anybody can keep it alive, they would go back to the top of the order. Fastball outside, 2-1. Fastball right down the middle, foul back on top of the roof. Now 2-2. The Hurricane fans breathing a little easier right now in their 18th College World Series appearance. Of course, Wayne Graham's wife over there not too happy about it. You can understand that.
Tough night. Such a roller coaster type of game because it looked like they had total command of the game. Rice was dominating the first four or five innings. Then it fell apart.
Tanya has had better nights following the ball club, but it's not over yet. Here's the 3-2. Got it. Four straight strikeouts for Vasquez.
The funny thing Coach Graham was saying, he said, well, we'll have a big crowd tonight. At least they'll drown out my wife yelling at the game.
Oh, you didn't have to say that. That's going to get Wayne in trouble now.
Well, she's saying,
an ardent supporter.
Enthusiastic
there you
fan.
Go. I'm trying to help you here.
There you go.
Strike call on the first pitch to Matt Fox.
Vasquez doing a great job of getting in front of the hitters. First pitch, second pitch.
0-2 threw that one a little, hung on to it.
Yeah, threw a little 50-footer right there.
Two out, nobody on here in the Rice eighth inning. Pretty pitch.
Really was. Started right at the hitter, broke it back over the plate.
Two and two. Matt Fox, a guy who seemed destined to come to Rice, both his uncle and his cousin played ball at Rice, and both were all Southwest Conference when they were members of that organization before it dissolved. Fastball misses outside, full count to Fox. Rice has been held scoreless for five innings. They scored two in the first and two in the third. Miami got four in the fifth, one in the sixth, two in the seventh. Struck him out. Five in a row. Fanned by Vasquez. We go to the bottom of the eighth. 7-4. Hurricanes.
Hi, Mattress Mack here to say that proper sleep provides us with the right stuff. It prepares our mind and bodies for peak performance. Folks, did you know that you may be sleep deprived? Do you have to have an alarm clock to wake you up every morning? Do you hit that snooze button over and over again? Do boring meetings put you to sleep? If so, you may be sleep deprived. And the best way to cure that sleep deprivation is to come out to Gallery Furniture and buy one of these Simmons Beauty Rest sleep sets recommended by Dr. James Moss, author of Power Sleep. Gallery Furniture gets you a power night's sleep. Gallery saves you money.
Our bodies need good food. That's why every day we should have at least one what?
Classic shake combo.
Yes, a classic shake combo with a frosty shake made with real ice cream. And where do we go for milkshakes made with real ice cream?
McDonald's?
Question?
My mommy says ice cream milkshakes make you fat.
Tell your mommy to be happy with who she is and stop being bitter about her thighs.
Okay.
Last year, Lee Jansen took the trophy at the U.S. Open. Now the stage is set as Duvall, Woods, and the game's hottest players square off for golf's greatest prize, the 1999 U.S. Open, Thursday at 11 and 5 on ESPN.
That I fear. Go to the bottom of the eighth inning here in Omaha with Miami having taken a 7-4 lead. Here is our storyline. Rice led 4-0 in the fourth inning, the Nike storyline. But the pitching staff has allowed 9 walks, hit a batter, and Fox, the third baseman, with brilliant plays but three throwing errors. Miami Hill has come through with three hits. Klute, the number nine man, two for three, including a homer, and they've gotten seven runs since the fifth inning to erase a 4-0 deficit.
Well, when you're playing a team that's a contact ball club that doesn't rely on power, you can't have nine walks and commit three errors and think you're going to win a ball game. That's an awful steep hill to try to climb right there.
Seaver will lead it off in the eighth against Kurtz Nickel. Breaking ball in there for a called strike, and his job right now is just to keep it at three runs. Rice will send the top of the order up in the ninth inning. Chopped foul, 0-2.
And for Miami, you want to get at least one, hopefully two more runs, because a grand slam will not beat you.
And we have seen some grand slams out here.
Yes, we have.
And a couple of 103-run jobs. Mm-hmm. And Rice has the power. But Vasquez has been exceptional coming out of the bullpen. Striking out 5 men in a row, he has total command of everything. Seaver, Crespo, and Esquivel, the scheduled hitters for the Canes. 2-3-4 in the order. In the dirt again, Curry has had an active night. 3-2 to Seaver. Got it into right for a base hit. Seaver, who all year has seemed to find a way to get it done, leads off the eighth with a single.
Well, that's nice stroke to right field. That's his patent stroke. He stayed right behind the ball, Mike. You talked about that earlier. Staying inside the ball, you stay behind it and just stayed inside out. Little Kevin Seitzer looking swing right there, shooting that ball to the right side of the infield. Testing your baseball knowledge with that stroke.
And let's see what Jim Morris wants to do here. Seaver has stolen 18 bases. Crespo stands in. Strike called against the left-hander. Michael New, the closer, is up. At this point, presumably just in case, or they may want to put him in and get him the work in the ninth.
Vasquez was awful sharp, but
I wouldn't touch Vasquez. I'd keep him pitching till Sunday.
Telling you. That's the amazing thing about Major League Baseball, because I see that an awful lot, is that you may have a pitcher who's extremely hot in the eighth, and he looks great, and they still want to go to their closer.
Out he comes. Crespo checks the swing, another pitch down low. Well, sometimes people are the victims of their own success. If the formula starts to work, that's all they see, the formula, not what else may be happening on the field.
Absolutely right.
And yet they go to the formula because it has been successful. Ripped into the hole between short and third. Crespo with a ringing single. Runners at first and second. Nobody out. So we have not seen Jim Morris go to small ball. He's letting them swing away and they're delivering. Sports Century's countdown of the top 50 North American athletes of the past century comes up next. ESPN2, Johnny Unitas, number 32 in the countdown. The cult legend was the NFL Player of the Year 3 times, elected into the Hall of Fame in 1979. His old high-top shoes, throwing to Raymond Berry. Just brilliant.
One of my all-time favorites.
I think he and Dan Marino are the two best I ever saw. And certainly in his era, Unitas was the best to play.
Yeah. Well, Vasquez is done, so I think we're going to see Mr. New. Unless he comes out there and rips that ice off and goes back up.
No, I think he's done. Esquivel with runners at first and second, and he wants to sacrifice. excellent punt. Beautiful. They throw him out at first. Matt Fox makes the play, but the sacrifice is perfect. He sees the first baseman come in to take it away from him, so he bunts it to third and gets the runners over.
You're absolutely right. Great job of bunting. And that only comes from, you don't worry about the first baseman. You're not bunting it there. You want to go to third. He knew where he wanted to put it, and he drops it down perfectly. Fox, being aggressive, comes up and makes a nice play and a strong throw across the diamond.
Escoville comes out, or Vasquez comes out of the bullpen and fans the last five guys he sees. And now Wayne Graham wants to come out to talk it over. They'll go with Gwynn coming out of the bullpen and obviously have to bring the infield in, trailing by three runs here in the eighth. We'll check it out when we come back.
ESPN Sports Century, a television retrospective covering 100 years of sports. And now you can read all about it. Look for ESPN Sports Century magazine this Sunday in these leading newspapers.
Call 1-800-HAIR-CLUB right now for a free brochure. Your free hair, all you have to do is prepay for a basic club plan. That's it.
Can't believe you can slick it straight back and it still looks natural. I love it. I've never felt this good after a haircut.
You don't feel any difference in this hair, you know, any hair. And it still stays, see?
So call 1-800-HAIR-CLUB right now for a free brochure.
Miami 7-4 in the bottom of the eighth. They've come from behind to erase a 4-0 deficit. Vasquez, brilliant out of the bullpen. Two innings, five strikeouts, not even a loud foul.
Oh, he was excellent, Mike, because he did a great job of getting that first pitch across, and then he got guys to chase bad pitches right there to split. Fastball, he's moving it all over. Another split, a little slider, I should say. I keep saying split, I mean slider. And there's another slider and another one. But he set it up because he was busting that fastball in and away, and he would get ahead of the hitters, 0-1, 0-2, almost every time he walked out there.
This is Mark Gwynn, the new pitcher, a junior from the Woodlands, Texas, 6'3", 215, 7-1 this year, and comes in to try to hold him at three runs here in the ninth. Facing Kevin Brown, who fouls the first pitch back. Runners at second and third. Infield drawn in, and the only thing you can look for here is try to get the strikeout.
Yeah, that's all you can look for. If you elect, you've already made your election that you're not going to go ahead and put the runner on. You've got your whole infield drawn in. So, you got to go for the punch out.
And Brown is the big power on the lineup. Breaking ball drops low.
I remember when we were playing in spring training against college teams, they'd have that aluminum bat, and they say, infield in. I tell the manager, you come in.
Yeah, absolutely. Hit in the air to straightaway center. Gray coming on, now drifting to the right center. That's going to get the run home. Sacrifice fly for Kevin Brown. And an RBI, and it's now 8-4.
Well, that's a great piece of hitting by Brown just to get the ball in the air. Ball got in on him a little bit, but he was so strong, he was strong enough to drive it out into the outfield and pick up the run. But his approach, Mike, is what was impressive because he was trying to go up the middle the other way, and that's going to always keep you on the ball a little bit longer.
Rodriguez stands in now with two outs and a runner to third. Crespo advanced on the flyout. So Miami now with that four-run lead. Breaking ball high to Rodriguez.
Well, this is almost like they put a jump-and-run press on Rice and just took them totally out of their game. Because Rice was in total control of this ball game.
Certainly looked that way, didn't it? Rodriguez has been the team's best left-hand hitter all year out of Cooper City, Florida.
Well, we saw him hanging there on one of the country's top left-handed pitchers, so you know he's a fearless hitter, and that's what you got to be when you're hitting. You have to be fearless. He has a great approach at the plate on top of that.
Is that the 10th walk, Marty Arenado, given up by Rice? 10.
Marty's on top of it. You know,
isn't he? Always.
10 walks, 3 errors, 4 errors.
And now Lovelady with a chance to add to a 4-run lead. Up and in.
Now, I would not be surprised to see a stolen base here or maybe even a play to try to get to the 5-run lead instead of a 4-run lead. Maybe that's what they're discussing out here at the mound right now.
Well, with 2 outs, the question is always, do you throw through and try to get the guy at second base? Of course, his job, if the ball's thrown through, is to stop.
Right. You know, college baseball is so different than the pro game, so you have no idea what they're going to do.
There he goes. Strike called. They throw through, and it's not in time. The runner is holding at third.
Well, the ball was thrown so low that Crespo, the runner at third, now he cannot judge if that's a playback to the pitcher or not, so he's got to freeze, because if it's back to the pitcher, he's out. Now watch how low this throw is. The pitcher has almost got to duck a little extra to get over him. It short hops the second baseman, so Crespo's got to freeze. Usually, he will try to take off when the ball crosses the pitcher's head, and you got an idea how high the ball's being thrown, but when it's down low, you just have to freeze. That's all you can do.
Runners at second and third with 2 out and a 1-2 count on Lovelady. A base hit here would give Miami a huge cushion going to the ninth. Already up by 4. Struck him out. So Rice gets out of the inning, but Miami adds 1. They are now up by 4. Rice will send the top of the order to the plate in the top of the ninth.
The marvel of its aerodynamics. The sheer exhilaration of takeoff. It's enough to make an aerospace engineer jealous. Chrysler Concorde. With a 200 horsepower V6 engine that's remarkably powerful, yet fuel efficient. Now, lease a Concorde LX for $289 a month. Chrysler. Engineered to be great cars.
At Circuit City, we have everything you need for your computer.
From software and hardware to printers, high-speed modems, memory, or you can design your own system.
Right now at Circuit City, get rebates from $5 to $300 on great top brands throughout the store. Save $250 on this compact computer with 15-inch monitor and color printer, now just $729.99 after rebates. Don't miss the savings in every department right now at Circuit City.
We go to the ninth with Miami leading Rice 8-4, and the Hurricanes have brought in their closer. As you see the line score, those 4 big Rice errors to go with 10 walks. But Michael New, the nation's leader in strikeouts per inning, will come on to try to close this down. 14.9 strikeouts per 9 is what his record is. He leads the club in appearances and saves with 13, also has 3 wins and a 3.15 ERA.
Well, Michael New is going to face for a fastball, a curveball, and a change. Now, the interesting thing is this funky windup. He gets about halfway through and he pauses, almost like a Japanese windup. And that's what throws off a lot of hitters, particularly in the college game. They haven't seen that kind of movement before, so it takes a little while to get used to him. By then, he's coming in to close out a game. You don't get another at bat off him.
And it seems to make the fastball look faster, doesn't it?
Yes, it does. The rally caps are on, Mike.
And that's exactly what they need, at least 4 to keep it going. Williams, Smith, and Thames, the scheduled hitters. Will Ford, the cleanup man, if they can keep it going. And the Rice fans trying to get the crowd into it. Williams 0-2 with a couple of walks tonight.
See that hesitation right there in the windup?
Does look Japanese.
Yes, it does.
High and outside, two straight fastballs, 2-0. Wouldn't be surprised if Williams is just going to make him throw a couple in there now.
Yeah, actually, probably the first three hitters will probably go ahead and take a strike.
Two and one. Fastball low, 3-1.
He's got to take right here, too. Take it to 3-2. Now, New can get behind on some hitters and come back. He
lost him.
Three walks for Williams tonight. A weird game, Mike. Your leadoff hitter has three walks.
And two strikeouts.
And you score four runs.
Yeah. Dave Ryan. Dave?
Well, Mike, the Rice Owls could use some help from their good luck charm, the Rally Owl. It started making appearances outside the Rice dugout after the team lost the first game of their Super Regional to Southwestern Louisiana at the Astrodome in Houston. Reserve catcher John Lucan had the plastic owl as apartment. He brought it to change the team's luck. It worked down there. They won two straight games, won the Super Regional to advance here to Omaha. They need about four runs worth of good luck now, guys, in addition to the Rally Caps.
Dave, I'm a little disappointed. In a school that's as good as Rice, as smart as these kids are, that owl ought to be moving. Smith, who has a pair of singles for his efforts tonight against the nation's premier closer, Michael New. Fastball right down the pipe, 0-1.
Now you've got the infield playing back. First baseman's not even holding Williams. The book says don't run here. You might line into a double play.
Hit down to first. Looked at second, and then Brown decides to go to first and get the sure out.
Well, it was a wise decision on Brown's part. You go ahead. You're up four. You play one out at a time. You don't want to go ahead and make a throw to second base to try to get the lead runner. If you miss, now you got yourself in trouble. He hits a ground ball. Plus, he's spinning. Now, when you start to spin and make a throw, it's just too risky. Get the out. That's all you want. Take it one at a time.
It's an excellent decision. You're right. If he makes a bad throw, you're a bloop and a blast away from a tie ball game.
Exactly.
Damon Thames.
Plus, your coach is already telling you, we're giving him a base. We're playing back. We're going to give him a base. If they want to have second, they can have it.
377 on the year after a 1-for-3 night. Ford is on deck. Two and oh, New thought he had that one.
I thought he did too. I don't know what the strike zone is.
It's been dancing a little.
Yeah. Been in and out a little bit.
There's the strike, Denise. 2-1. The Rice fans have progressively been getting on the umpires tonight.
Dad's got the rally cap on up there. Uh-oh.
Hill threw it wide, but they make the tag at first. Good play by Kevin Brown, and two gone.
Well, the reason I said uh-oh, as soon as Bobby Hill sat back on that, I knew something was going to go wrong. Either the throw was going to tail, or he wasn't going to get anything on it. You want to continue to stay aggressive. Now, he sits back. He's got a strong enough arm to make it up. He uses a quick feet, but what happens is you rush your arm angle, and fortunately, you got the great tag from the first baseman to get him.
Last chance for Rice, and it's Will Ford. They need four runs, a runner at third and two out. This is not a save situation for New, but he wants to close it out nonetheless.
Yeah, you come with your best stuff here. You don't worry about a save or anything else in the World Series. You want that W.
scoreboard with a home run, four runs batted in tonight.
I was surprised to see the check swing on the first pitch by Ford because I thought he would be taking all the way.
Of course, it's tough to put yourself in a hole against a guy as good as new.
I used to hate that with Eckersley. You know, he walks one guy all year, and you go up there, and the manager says, take a strike.
Take a couple, yeah. Vasquez, who was so brilliant, fanning his last five of the six batters he faced. That's it. Michael New comes out of the bullpen, strikes out four to end the ball game. And Miami, an improbable comeback as they look dead in the water down 4-0 to the Owls of Rice, but they have come back to win it 8-4. So here in bracket one, today's winners, Alabama and Miami, they will meet Sunday afternoon. Oklahoma State and Rice will battle in the first elimination game of the series. Bracket 2 starts tomorrow. Texas A&M against second-seeded FSU on CBS. Then at 8 Eastern on ESPN2, Cal State Fullerton taking on the Stanford Cardinal. Our final score, Miami 8, Rice 4 for Harold Reynolds and Dave.
Rice leads it 4-0. Same score in the bottom of the fifth inning. Miami's Bobby Hill with a long fly to left. Watch for the obvious fan interference here. Right there, but they still call it a home run. Miami within 2-4-2. 4-3 Owls still in the fifth. Mike Rodriguez singles to left. Lolly Esquivel scores. Game is tied at 4. And in the bottom of the sixth, still tied at 4, Chris Klute. Homers to left field. Canes led at 5-4. Go on to knock off the Owls. 8-4, but remember, it is double elimination. In New York, the Knicks are trying to close
on top seeded Miami in the featured game, and Wayne Graham's Owls jumped on the Hurricanes early. In the top of the third, when Will Ford ripped his pitch over the right field wall for a two-run homer, the Owls were soaring, leading 4-0. But in the bottom of the fifth, look what happens. Miami comes back. This hit off the bat of Bobby Hill starts the trouble. Looks like it's going to hit off the wall, but a fan reaches down and catches it. The umpire calls it a two-run homer. The game is tied by the end of the fifth, and then in the bottom of the sixth, Chris Klute hits a solo homer to give Miami a 5-4 lead, and the Canes go on to win it 8-4. Rice will next play Oklahoma State in the loser's bracket because in the day's first game, Alabama beat Oklahoma State. Jeremy Brown got things going for the Crimson Tide with his two-run homer in the second. Bama had three homers in the game. They clobbered the Cowboys 11-3. Let's move now to high school baseball action.